morning and welcome to the 8th and final meeting in 2016 of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. And before we move to the first item of agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch off their mobile phones as they may affect the broadcasting system. However, committee members do consult tablets on which the papers for the meeting are to be found. We've also been joined today by Aileen Murray, MSP, Jackie Bailey, MSP, and Joan McAlpine, MSP, for our consideration of subordinate legislation, and I welcome them to the meeting. Agenda item one is subordinate legislation, and the first item today is to take evidence on the sub-ledge as listed on the agenda, i.e. the Conservation of Salmon Scotland Regulations 2016/115, the Salmon Carcass Tagging Scotland Regulations 2016/116, the Tweed Regulation Salmon Carcass Tagging Order 2016/117, and the Tweed Regulation Salmon Conservation Order 2016/118. A motion to annul the Conservation of Salmon Scotland Regulation 2016/115 has been lodged by Alec Fergusson. And as is the usual practice in such circumstances, we'll have evidence sessions first with the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Food and Environment to ask questions, to answer questions, we hope, and we'll seek clarification. And I welcome Richard Lockhead today with his supporting officials, Willie Cowan, Head of Performance, Aquaculture and Recreational Fisheries, and Jeff Gibbons, Head of Wild Fisheries, and Stuart Middlemas, Head of Ecology Programme, Scottish Government. Good morning, gentlemen. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would like to make some opening remarks.
Good morning, Convener and members of the committee, especially given I understand this is your last meeting of this parliamentary session, and it's been good working with you over the last few years. Can I just say that I welcome this opportunity this morning to discuss the salmon conservation measures through the Conservation of Salmon Scotland Regulations 2016 and the Tweed Regulation Salmon Conservation Order 2016 as well. I want to briefly outline why the government is bringing forward legislation to protect and conserve what is, of course, an iconic species in this country. These measures are designed to manage the exploitation of salmon, not just because it's a protected species under the Habitats Directive, but because we believe it's the right thing to do. Salmon is synonymous with Scotland. I want Scotland to be synonymous with good management of this natural resource and the social and economic benefits that can bring, be brought for generations to come. I think it would be helpful just to remind ourselves of the background to these measures. They are a product of significant stakeholder engagement and reflection at the same time. The committee will be aware that the genesis for these measures rests with recommendations within the Independent Wild Fisheries Review, which was published in 2014, to progress the introduction of a kill licence. The review recommended that this matter be given immediate consideration, given the conservation status of wild salmon. That recommendation, which we did accept, led to a consultation early last year on the broad principles behind the introduction of a licensing scheme. This was followed by a concerted effort during the summer period to engage with stakeholders through a series of drop-in events and online dialogue to support consultation on the detail of what the proposed scheme should look like. Finally, in the autumn, we consulted on a revised package of measures which currently constitute the measures we are discussing today. So it's been a very consultative process over a significant period of time, and over 1,000 responses have been received. It's not necessarily an unprecedented level of responses, but does certainly represent the level of personal investment many people have made within the sector. So the regulations now form part of a package which, taken together, firstly prohibits the killing of wild salmon within coastal waters, also enables the killing of wild salmon within inland waters to be managed according to the conservation status, and introduces a power to agree a conservation plan, and finally provides for net caught fish in river in category 1 and 2 areas to be carcass tagged. The introduction of a conservation plan demonstrates that we are looking to understand and, where possible, quantify all of the various factors that impact on the determination of conservation status. This is not about apportioning blame or responsibility, but rather to better understand how best to target resources to manage and conserve our salmon stocks at a local and national level. We are looking to work with local fisheries managers to identify how all of these potential impacts can be mitigated. But all of that together does present an opportunity to improve the conservation status of salmon. Currently, my officials are discussing the draft template for a conservation plan with local biologists to ensure that they're fit for purpose and deliver in the areas that have been identified that require action. It's an important initiative and one I hope everyone will look to engage with in what's hopefully going to be a positive and constructive manner. I want to place on record, I do recognise there has been a delay in laying the regulations. However, much of that simply reflects the time we've taken to understand and respond to the concerns and questions raised by anglers and other wild fisheries interests. I am, however, conscious there are some concerns about the robustness of the data used to underpin the assessment of conservation status. The assessments use the best available data, including data from rod catch and electronic fish counters. The methodology used is also in line with that used in other countries, although, of course, tailored to the Scottish situation. When the regulations were laid, we gave a commitment to listen to new evidence and information from local fisheries managers and, if necessary, to amend the categorisation. Marine Scotland is very willing to work with and support fishing interests to adapt through the implementation of these regulations as we move forward. The goal is eventually to be able to categorise on a river-by-river level, but that's not something that can be delivered at the moment. We have met and will continue to meet with local biologists to discuss the current process and look at how the data supporting the determination of conservation status can be developed and refined for future years. Now, many angling clubs continue to express concern about the potential impact that mandatory catch and release will have on their clubs, many of which are already facing declining membership numbers. To help mitigate the potential impact of these measures, we will be funding a two-year programme to support angling clubs that need assistance in promoting catch and release as a sustainable and responsible practice. My officials are also in discussion with the Crown Estate about how they might take a pragmatic view when discussing what can be done to assist angling association tenants who have raised concerns over their financial viability, particularly, but not exclusively, as a result of the measures we are discussing today. We're also in discussion with those affected by the prohibition on coastal netting about the financial impact on their businesses as well. So I want to place on record my appreciation for the way in which the coastal netsmen and their representative body have engaged with us to date on the measures and the positive manner in which they have looked to work with us. I know that much of the dialogue that's taken place has not been easy, understandably so, but many people in the sector are aware of the basis on which we are moving forward. We're also looking to widen our science focus to encompass a broader Scottish perspective, including more specific work on the economic viability and the practice of ranching and the impact of cultural activities, such as half netting as well. Many coastal netsmen remain optimistic that the prohibition could be lifted in the future and that they can have the opportunity to fish thereafter in a sustainable manner. So I'll finish where I began, saying that clearly some of these changes and the dialogue around it has not been easy for all involved. But I do believe the regulations now strike the right balance between conservation of the species for the benefit of future generations and the interests of those who fish for salmon today. And myself and particularly my colleagues here will do our best to answer any questions as you take evidence in this matter today.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I've got people who've indicated the wish to ask questions. Dave Thompson first.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your team. It's a very specific constituency question, really, Cabinet Secretary, and it's to do with the river Lochy. This will have wider implications than just the Lochy and other rivers in Loch Abar. And you mentioned ranching when you were speaking there, and they've been developing ranching of salmon for quite some time now in the Lochy particularly, but quite a number of other rivers in Loch Abar, where the fish are reared and the eggs are taken from particular rivers and they're reared and they're put back into these and they clip the fins, they can identify them when they catch them. And they're doing a lot of scientific work in relation to this, which I think will be beneficial in terms of your overall scientific approach that you'll be taking to all of this. But in order to do what they do, they need to kill these fish. So it was really to ask you what, I mean, I don't see anything in the regulations per se that would allow that to happen, but in terms of the science and so on, can you give me some assurance that you will be working with the River Lochy people to ensure that the research they've been doing over quite a number of years can continue, and they're still able to kill these fish as part of that.
Okay. Clearly, as I said in my own remarks, there are some specific issues where discussions, good constructive discussions, have been taking place across the sector to do with these individual circumstances and arrangements that are in place in certain rivers. And you mentioned Lochy, and I'm aware of Dave Thompson's interest in that issue, and can give him an assurance that, yes, ranching is recognised in terms of its importance and the role it's playing at the moment in terms of restocking. And I think you've well highlighted how there is a way in which ranch fish can be identified. So our intention is for those constructive discussions to continue and hopefully have a positive outcome. So they are underway. We very much recognise that. I know that the officials are directly involved in those discussions. If you want to get some feedback.
Yeah, absolutely. We've been in discussion with the Lochy about the project, both in the context of the extent to which it's having a benefit from a commercial and a conservation basis. And I think at the moment, the focus has been more around a commercial aspect. So moving forward, any science would need to be interlinked to the conservation status work going forward, and that's quite critical. And we're working with them to see how that might take place, and those discussions continue at the moment.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Jim Hume, then Joan McAlpine.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary, etc. I do have concerns about some of these orders. Some of the data that's been used has been worked on regarding rod counts. That's actually the number of fish that have been caught on actual rivers, whereas, of course, when it's a dry summer, the fish don't run up the rivers, and there's plenty of them waiting in the seas. I've obviously met with half-netters and the likes down by the Solway area, so I'd be interested in the Cabinet Secretary's views regarding their property rights. They've had a royal charter for many hundred years. In discussions with Aileen McLeod, she said that the government was considering what sort of compensation would be available for them, those half-netters and the likes, to in losing their property rights. So that's one issue. Regarding the Tweed regulation, just a couple of issues. The Tweed Commission themselves are concerned about. They were wondering why sea trout were not included and it was only salmon. They're also obviously wondered why regulation was needed to have agreements between the Tweed Commission and ministers themselves, why that has to be regulation and why agreement has to be, as I say, regulated and not just done as an agreement between two organisations.
So I'll ask Jeff to answer the point about the need for regulations in the Tweed in the background to that, first of all, and I'll come back to you in the half, Nathan.
We had numerous conversations with the Tweed, very initial conversations about the kill licence approach and the importance to be able to demonstrate to Europe how we apply the Habitats Directive and how Scottish Government actually applies and meets its requirements on the Habitats Directive, which in part is a key driver for these regulations. So the need to demonstrate that we've made an assessment for the Tweed is reflected in the regulation, in the order, and is part of the annual assessment. So that was the reason why it needs to be in place. The Tweed are unable to demonstrate that they can comply with the Habitats Directive. It's our responsibility to do that from a European perspective. Equally, the focus for the initial kill licence approach was, as you know, a recommendation around protecting salmon because of the continuing issues of concerns around the diminishing salmon stocks to address that. And salmon is a protected species, and again, Europe had some concerns that we weren't more clearly able to demonstrate that we were meeting the compliance of Article 6 of the Habitats Directive. Mm-hmm. The information we've had around salmon, which we know others have suggested is not as robust as they would like, is clearly stronger than what we've got in the sea trout. So there is some irony that those who've questioned our robustness of the data on the salmon are equally pushing for a similar measure on sea trout, where the data is probably not as robust as well. Part of the package of measures that were announced was that we will look towards how we might progress the issue of regulation around sea trout going forward, And that's actually an issue that ICES and NASCO and others are actually considering at the moment, and there are a number of difficulties in that, but we are part of those discussions.
Mm-hmm. In terms of, I just want to just assure the committee that clearly no one in Scotland can say the data is perfect and doesn't require, you know, improving over the coming years, but we can only work with the data we have. But we do know that we have a conservation status issue with salmon in this country, and we want to improve the data clearly as we go forward. That applies in all areas of fisheries science. You always constantly have to improve your science and collect more science. And now we'll have a more stable way for moving forward. The conservation plans will play a role in that. And clearly, in terms of infractions proceedings from Europe, and in terms of the World Fisheries Review that took place in Scotland, there's a clear conservation problem and we have to act. We believe we've got enough data to justify what we're doing, and clearly the data we have and we've collected it is similar to other countries that have taken similar measures. But I just want to assure the committee, of course, we always want to improve the data as we move forward. But if you wait for the perfect data, the perfect science, it'll be far too late to save the salmon, and we don't want to be in that position. I don't want to be in that position. I'm sure the committee don't want to be in that position. But in terms of how we move forward and recognising the cultural importance of half-netting and other activities around Scotland, we're absolutely determined to work with the sector on each of those individual issues to make sure we're moving forward constructively.
Okay. And my first point, obviously, was regarding the property rights of half-netters and the like. Obviously, they're going to lose the right to do what they've been doing for hundreds of years. And the Minister previously said that they were considering, that yourselves were considering compensation. Is that still on the table?
We have discussions taking place with different parts of the sector on different issues. In terms of the half-netters, we'd want to work with them in the science to move forward, which may allow some project to be put together to allow them to continue their activities, as opposed to compensation.
Okay, right, thanks.
Okay, we've got a long list of people. So Joan McAlpine, Claudia Beamish, Elaine Murray, Jackie Bailey, Mike Russell, Alec Fergusson, Sarah Boyack, and Uncle Tom Gobley and all.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you for allowing me to your committee. Cabinet Secretary, my question is also about half-netters. I've raised the issue in a number of letters to your colleague, Dr. Aileen McLeod, and contributed to the consultation. My issue with the half-netters is the heritage, the fact that their culture is as important as obviously the preservation of salmon, because it only happens on the Solway, and it really is very unique and has happened since Viking times. You hinted there that there may be an opportunity going forward for half-netters to continue their cultural practice, which would mean taking a small amount of salmon. I wondered if you could go into any more detail about that.
Well, I know Joan McAlpine's taken a close interest in the cultural heritage of half-netting. I've read her eloquent articles in the media, as well as, I know, her letters to the government on this issue. And we likewise recognise the cultural heritage of half-netting. And that's why we are willing to specifically work with the half-netters on a scientific-based project, which in turn would enable some kind of activity to continue. That will be beneficial in terms of clearly developing science, at the same time providing an opportunity for the half-netting to continue. So that's what we are proposing, that discussions taking place between the officials and the half-netters.
So the half-netters would be perhaps involved in counting the number of fish and to help you improve your science, is that what you're saying?
Well, clearly, I'll ask officials to bring you up to date with the discussions, right, of what the nature of the scientific project might look like. You were asking to come in here.
We've had the I've met the half-netters a couple of times to discuss the issue for them. The actual activity can continue. The issue for them has been the fact that the inability to take one or two makes the activity not worth their while was the key message for them. And clearly we've had to balance that alongside the wider approach on conservation and the categorisation and other areas that similarly have looked and suggested their cultural heritage plays a role in how you manage this activity. What we're looking to do is to, because we need a wider geographical perspective in trying to determine and improve the science for conservation, determination going forward is look at how we might use other activities as part of that process, and the fact that we can potentially managed the number that the half-netters could kill, but a sufficient number to do some science is what we're currently looking at trying to do. So once we've got more detail, our intention is to go back, but we need to actually detail how that might look first before we approach them. We are conscious also that the season tends to start around about June, so that there's a time frame to fit into that, hopefully, as well.
OK. Thank you very much.
Claudia Beamish.
Cabinet Secretary and to the officials. Could I just continue on the line of questioning about the half-netters? And I know that my colleague, Elaine Murray, will be raising that issue as well. It is very important that these skills are retained from generation to generation. So what you've highlighted in relation to the science is an interesting point and perfectly valid, but the actual skills of the half-netting and that process in often dangerous waters in the Solway is something that is a very long tradition, as many of us are aware. And I've met some of them myself as well. Something has been highlighted as well from the half-netters about the possibility of a partial exemption. For instance, on the basis that on catch and release, they would argue that there is a 10% mortality of salmon, and that they argue that there isn't nearly so much, if any, mortality of salmon in their process of fishing, and that possibly, therefore, it could match what the rod anglers are doing, even where they're doing catch and release, and that just might be a suggestion, but I don't know if you've got any comment on that, or whether you could have been considering that.
I'll ask Jeff to come back on that point.
That was certainly when I met them, what they were discussing, when we talked about the level of mortality, or indeed acceptable perhaps levels of mortality under catch and release, I explained that that's also part of the process in terms of a requirement to meet the Habitats Directive, the extent to that activity and how that plays into your determination. And part of the discussion going forward around the conservation plan will be the extent to even allow the activity to take place, maybe having an impact on the current categorisation process, which is one of the areas where other parts of Europe have taken more draconian measures in terms of closing rivers, where we've not gone that route at the moment. I think we've taken a very method-neutral approach within river, basically because it's a fishing right, and how you apply that is very much up to the individual to choose that. Equally, we're not stopping people that undertaking the activities about the taking and the getting of the fish, which is the key issue. So we want to look at it, if we're going to move that forward, recognising the cultural and heritage issues that you've raised and others have raised as well, and that's been a similar measure for coastal netsmen and others as well, the extent to which that's a cultural activity as well. We can manage that in the context of science for conservation. That's a better way to go than looking at it in the context of whether the 10 or 12% on matching catch and release is actually a factor that we should play in. So we'll look at it in that wider context rather than the impact of allowing the angling activity.
Right, thank you. That's helpful. And, Convener, I've got another question. Thank you. Two of my colleagues are here as well today, Jackie Bailey and Elaine Murray, who want to highlight issues from their perspective. I've also been asked by both Dave Thompson and Rhoda Grant, who aren't able to attend. Sorry, I'm so sorry, Dave Thompson. He's not able to attend, he just happens to be sitting next to me. Dave Stuart as well, who aren't able to attend, to raise concerns. And this is really about the fact that the judgments on the gradings have been done very much, as we understand it, as lay people, on an area basis. And you have highlighted that this is going to become more detailed. But the concerns are for particular anglers on particular rivers. And if I could just quickly highlight just two points to give some evidence on this. Dave Sutherland, in Dave Stewart's constituent in his region, has highlighted that the River Ness, in their view, has been incorrectly graded a grade 3 river rather than a grade 2, and that he would argue that the process has been rushed and uses, and I'm quoting, botched data. This is his view. And that they stress that they already return 86% of fish to the river. So they are working on conservation issues in this way. And that they argue that the grade 3 is based on a tributary where the method of measuring female fish spawning is fatally flawed with third-party evidence to back this up. So that's one of the examples. And the other is in the same region, in Highland Region, highlighted from a constituent of Rhoda Grant's in Stornoway, Anton Michael or Michelle, and that's about the River Creed. And this has been banned from keeping salmon because the district has failed the test, and the fisheries managers have assessed the River Creed in the view of the local group, using the mainland test, assessing the River Creed individually on its own merit, and they argue that it would definitely have passed, but the government won't accept this information, and that the instrument again is too blunt. So I do take the point that we have to start somewhere, and I do recognise the importance of protecting salmon as a species, not only under the EU issue, but because it's iconic in Scotland. But I would like to know, is there really the capacity to move towards a more individual river base for judging, and how, if we did go forward with this regulation today, how would local groups be involved in a way that some of them feel frustrated that they haven't been listened to yet, because the instrument is quite blunt the first time around? And I really would be seeking reassurance for local anglers, really in quite a considerable amount of Scotland, where there are waters, you know, and this is not just big estates, this is local angling clubs and people who do it either as a hobby or as an enjoyment, but also brings local tourism and economic benefit. So it is very important to a number of colleagues who have constituent concerns. Thank you.
Okay. I'll ask colleagues to come in a second in terms of the capacity and how we'll approach that going forward, but clearly, whilst we have a lot of support for the categorisation approach, clearly there are many concerns being expressed on an individual basis when it comes to people's local rivers where they're angling. And we will very much rely on the input and data collection from the anglers moving forward as we move towards a river basis as opposed to fisheries district upon which the catch statistics at the moment are based. So we have to start there, but we do want to get to the river approach, and we want to do that as quickly as possible. Only 18% of the fish caught is retained in the Category 3 rivers at the moment. So by definition, the vast majority of fish caught are released voluntarily back into the rivers. So that activity clearly is protected because that can continue. So we're speaking about 18% is potentially going to have an impact in some situations around the country in terms of the viability of rivers and angling clubs and so on, and that's why we're taking other steps to try and address that. So yes, local anglers will have to play a crucial role in the data collection and improving the science as we move forward, and yes, also we want to get to a river basis for the categorisation as quickly as possible as well. That's certainly our very determined direction of travel. So I don't know if colleagues want to come in terms of the capacity of moving there as quick as we can.
Just maybe to explain why we look at districts rather than the river, it's that's because how data has been collected on rod catches. And when you put your rod catch return, you don't necessarily have to say where exactly it's come from. You can amalgamate, if you've got fishings on two rivers, you can amalgamate them into one return, provided it's within the same district. So at the moment, we don't actually have the information to be able to allocate all the catches to individual rivers. Now, we've started to do that over the past 6 to 9 months. We've started to do that, but it's a difficult kind of tangled process. But we are committed to spending a lot of time doing that. And hopefully for the next year, we'll be able to do river by river as much as we can. We hope to have it all done, but there may be some issues that we can't quite disentangle. So that's why it's districts just now, and that's why we're moving towards river, and we've put the kind of the way to do that in place, and the kind of people are working on that at the moment. I think the other part of the question was about engagement with locals. We've met to discuss with local biologists, so there's local biologists throughout the country through the Trust Network and through boards. We met with them in December to discuss the these issues, how conservation limits were collected and where we could feed local data in. They've sent us information on data they hold. Certainly some of them have. And we're also in discussions about setting up working groups on different parts of the process. And they've started to feed into that. We'll be setting those working groups in. At first, they will be very focused on how we can get things done for next year, because there's reasonably tight deadlines on that, so how we can improve the initial process. But there will also be discussions, wider discussions, about how we can improve the general process, what other routes we can take going forward.
Right, thank you. And lastly, could I just ask if there's been any assessment of what the implications for the protection and conservation of salmon are going forward for the future, for per se and for, of course, the socioeconomic and enjoyment aspects of it. Has there been any assessment done of what the implications would be of a delay in order to get to have it less broad and more sort of localised, that would perhaps bring more people with you who have concerns at the moment?
Well, clearly two key drivers for acting now and not waiting until we have more information about the river statistics or whatever in the future, which we still want to get as quickly as possible so we can adapt the management to that, is firstly the interaction threats from the EU, which is very real and in itself would have an economic impact in Scotland if it's taken to the next level. And secondly, of course, the Wild Fisheries Review sought urgent action in terms of the conservation of salmon, which is a conservation argument. So both these issues impinge on the social economic argument, but clearly they're the two key drivers. It's not easy to get accurate information on the direct economic impact of angling clubs simply because at the moment only 18% of the fish is retained. So whilst we're getting some information clearly from some angling clubs that they're very fearful for the future, when we explain that only 18% of the fish is actually retained and the other 82% of activity can continue, clearly that just changes the terms of the debate sometimes. So that's where we are at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you, Colina.
Aileen Murray, Jackie Bailey, Mike Russell.
Thank you, Convener, and it's nice to be here at the last meeting of the Rural Affairs Committee, since I was actually here at the first meeting of the Rural Affairs Committee. Minister, Cabinet Secretary, what I'm hearing from you is these decisions have been made on the basis of pretty dodgy science. And I think the issue of the half-netters has been well covered by various of my colleagues. It's not just about the half-netters in Dumfries and Galloway. It's also about angling. It's also about fishing tourism, because people come to my area for the weekend from the Central Belt, from the north of England, and people want maybe to take back with them a salmon, not huge numbers of salmon, but something, some sort of souvenir of their visit. And I'm told by the angling clubs that the level three categorisation is based on inappropriate science, that electronic counters have not been applied in the south of Scotland. It's been based on rod catch, which is dependent on weather, indeed on the number of anglers. And so some of these angling clubs are struggling, actually. There are fewer salmon being caught because there are fewer anglers, not because it's fewer salmon. It's also been pointed out to me that the River Annan, where much of the half-netting goes on at the mouth of the Annan, actually has been a productive river in three out of the last 5 years. And this, the science on which this is based is based on a very a narrow time frame. And in fact, salmon populations are cyclical. So I would ask you, on what basis are you categorising both the River Nith and the River Annan as level three? Because it is very much the experience of people who know the rivers well to say that actually that's an incorrect categorisation for these rivers.
Clearly, some of the debates you highlight perfectly legitimately and the concerns being expressed, are no doubt also legitimate to an extent as well, are very familiar from fisheries management, be it for salmon or be it for other species in our waters. Because the tourism, the fishing activity is dependent on sustainable stocks. If we don't have the sustainable stocks and we don't address some of these issues, we lose the tourism and we lose the fishing activities. So we're trying to get to a sustainable position where we can ensure future generations have the same opportunities to enjoy the tourism benefits and other economic benefits and social benefits that current generations have. And that's what this is about. As we've explained previously, we want to move to a river-by-river basis as quickly as possible. but we have to use the data we have at the moment, and it's perfectly possible to move there quickly when we get the data. So I'm trying to reassure your local anglers that whilst they may not be happy with the basis which we're moving forward at the moment, we want to adapt as quickly as possible as we get more accurate information. But for the reasons already explained in response to other questions, we have to act and act now. I'll ask colleagues to come in specifically on the Nith and Annan rivers, from maybe a science point of view, in terms of the claims that we're not using good data.
I think certainly I can say that we're speaking to the kind of local biologists in the Annan and Nith data about taking on data they have. I think one of the problems we have from the kind of science side is we can take on data when it's people's feelings about the river, that's more difficult to capture, but certainly information that they have will be fed into the process. We're in discussions with colleagues from the kind of southwest.
The anglers and the communities who depend, or the tourism industry is dependent on that, are perfectly well aware that their activities will cease if there are no salmon left. People are intelligent enough to realise that. And what I can't understand is why you can't have a more localised approach, because everybody believes that you have to conserve salmon, but it's actually about getting that balance and allowing localised solutions. And this is actually, to my mind, a blunt instrument to deal with the problem.
I can only give Aileen Murray an assurance and others that we are urgently wanting to get to a river-by-river basis. But we have to act now with the data we have now, and that's really why we have to move forward.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener. And my interest, of course, is the Loch Lomond Angling Improvement Association. It's been a fascinating session, because what I would characterise this as is the Cabinet Secretary saying, just pass this order, we'll worry about the detail later. And what he's at pains to reassure us about is that he will move quickly to looking at the evidence on a river-by-river basis. And I hear that reassurance. But I also heard Mr. Middlemas give us an idea of the complexity of what would be involved and talk about a year, if not more. So the speed that the Cabinet Secretary desires is just not going to happen in practical terms, not down to any lack, of civil servants' efforts, but just because the data is complex. Now, I wonder then, it's not about waiting for the perfect data, I accept that, but the impact of what you do will happen now, and no matter the speed at which you move, that impact will still be felt by anglers' associations across the country. There is science available to you now. And I wonder, what discussions you've had with Loch Lomond Angling Improvement Association, because they independently do their science through Glasgow University and the Loch Lomond Fisheries Trust. Salmon stocks are in fact growing, which is contrary to the assumption being made here. So why have they been categorised as a Category 3?
It's not so much a case of asking the committee to pass the legislation and then worry about the detail later. What we're saying is we have to worry about the state of salmon stocks in Scotland now. Yeah, that's the message clearly from the infraction proceedings from Europe, which is a very real threat, because we are way behind where we should be in terms of this fisheries management. And also we have to worry about the recommendations and the good work that's carried out with the Wild Fisheries Review, which says we have to act urgently and act now. So that's what I'm worrying about at the moment, as well as the detail that has to be improved. Yes, it has to be improved as quickly as possible in the future. Clearly, our approach is going to be, and I'm speaking to officials about this, is where there's evidence for recategorisation of rivers or fisheries districts, we have to undertake that as quickly as possible. And I just want to give Jackie Bailey and other members of the committee an assurance that, that's a very real issue for us, because we know that there's very specific issues around the country. It may even be in relation to specific activities like the half-netters that Joan McAlpine and Jim Pume and others were mentioning, or the ranching and the Lochy, or indeed specific data issues for specific rivers within fisheries district areas. So I just want to assure the committee we want to act on those as quickly as possible, but we have to act now.
Okay, can I come back on that? Yeah. And say, in relation to Loch Lomond Angling Association in particular, are we talking weeks, months, years? Has there been any discussion with them about the data they already have? Because that's not science you need to wait for, that's science that's here now.
Well, I'll ask officials to come in about direct conversations with Loch Lomond Improvement Association. But clearly these regulations come in shortly in terms of April, if they're passed today by the committee. And from there on in, we're going to be working on these other issues. We're already working on them, and we'll bring forward the changes as quickly as we can. But in terms of direct conversations with Loch Lomond, I know we've been...
Jeff, they both want in.
Willie, you go first.
Jeff will touch on Loch Lomond in a second. But I think it's important to consider in the round what the government is proposing to do, aligned with what other jurisdictions have done. So Ireland found themselves in a very similar situation a number of years ago, and they got infracted by the EU, excuse me, and they now have a system where on an annual basis they decide whether rivers are open or closed, full stop. So the government has taken a position for socio-economic reasons that they would rather not go down the open-close route because that is very impactful. But in relation to catch and release, the average Cabinet Secretary has already talked about the proportion of fish taken in the catch and release areas. If you average that out, and obviously averages by their nature are up and down on individual circumstances, but if you average that out, we're talking about 20 fish per district, which seems to me to be manageable. Jeff?
I had the privilege of attending the recent meeting of the Loch Lomond Angling Improvement Association, and there was a pretty strong feeling in the room around this issue, and they weren't slow in making that known. I think there was a number of factors for them. This is not a measure that doesn't allow them to continue the activity, and indeed, similarly, when we went around this year around the kill licence, most anglers said they just want to kill one. But one times 200,000 anglers who visit Scotland is quite a lot of fish. But they all felt that it was more a case, I think, that they didn't like a statutory approach as opposed to a voluntary approach. But when we explained by and large the issues around Europe and demonstrating that we're managing the activity, that's quite an important part of the process. So that was a key point for them. For Loch Lomond, one of the other issues in common with a lot of the angling clubs is a degree of underreporting in terms of the stats because of concerns that the more they report, the more that increases their payments elsewhere, levies go up or other factors. And that has come through as part of the discussion we've had with a lot of these clubs that actually the stats that have been provided aren't accurate because they're concerned by being accurate, it will have other areas of impact. So we had to address that with them, and that's reveal some additional data. It doesn't mean we weren't working on the correct data. We're working on the data we were provided with, but there were reasons why they had chosen not to be as accurate, perhaps, as they might have been, or that was certainly the going forward. The Loch Lomond Angler Improvement Association aren't totally at one in their view around the measure. There was a clear split in the room, and indeed there was a strong thoughts around managing catch and release being the right thing to do, and very conservation-minded. But what I have said to them, we've been in engagement. We've had lots of discussions with them. We have regular dialogue. More information they can provide, the more we will look at this measure. And if there's an opportunity to see sufficient evidence to suggest that a recategorisation is appropriate, and we've been open to that, but we've had to work with the data we've got. So in some instances, it's because of underreporting. We admit there's not as much counter data as we'd like, and that's part of the wider scoping exercise that Marine Scotland has conducted about a potential counter network for Scotland. Then we can revisit that, and we will revisit it as quickly as that data comes through. But equally, we've got to make sure that data can be validated and is appropriate to be able to use for our science.
But nobody has given me a timescale, and I'm genuinely asking. You know, if the Cabinet Secretary is saying it's going to be really quick, is that weeks? Is that months? Is that years? Because I think Mr. Middlemas quite rightly reflected on the complexity of this. Nobody's given me a timescale.
Well, what I said was we'd do it as quickly as possible, but clearly the regulations come in shortly. And throughout the first year, a lot of this work will continue, and we'll bring forward proposals on the basis of scientific evidence once we have the scientific evidence.
Can I ask about, very quickly, has an equality impact assessment been done on these proposals? Because 40% of the members of Loch Lomond Angling Association have protected characteristics. So has an equality impact assessment been done on the impact on their members?
The issue here, as has been said before, is that the proposals do not preclude people from undertaking the activity. What it precludes them from doing is killing a fish.
With respect, that wasn't my question. My question was, has an equality impact assessment been done?
Well, we always carry equality impact assessments and legislation, so I have to...
As part of the wider discussion, we looked at the impact on clubs, where there were special issues, and that was built into the BRIA as well discussion.
It still doesn't answer my question, but thank you, Convener.
Mike Russell.
I want to know about process in this, because what concerns me, and I'll... Convener, I want to say something during the debate more widely about how this has been reached, but I just want to have some information about process. When did somebody decide to recommend to the Minister that this was the set of proposals that met the objectives which you had set? When and how?
Well, clearly the Environment Minister has been, as you know, heavily involved in this for a long time now, ever since the recommendations came from the Wild Fisheries Review, and we have a stakeholder reference group, and the consultation responses to the initial proposal for the kill licence was taken into account. So over the last 18 months, 2 years, clearly that's been an ongoing issue. So how much detail you want in terms of...
I do want to press you further on this. I just want to know how this happened. Because these are a set of proposals which are controversial, which some people bitterly resent. And I just want to know how we have got to this stage. I want to talk later on about how we can avoid getting to this stage in all of our environmental activities, something I've talked about quite often in this committee. But in this case, how did we get here?
The short answer is by listening to people, but I'll ask officials because I don't really want to come in here who've been involved with stakeholder direct contact over the last 2 years.
Okay, so broadly speaking, as the Cabinet Secretary indicated in his opening statement, there was a general consultation this time last year on the kill licence. We took the responses from that consultation exercise and provided advice to ministers, which were then published as a statutory notice, which indicated the potential introduction of a kill licence. As a result of the consultation responses from that statutory notice, ministers reconsidered the position and adopted the basis of the regulation now before you, which is not a kill licence as such, but it's a very much more simplified regime which enables the government to demonstrate to Europe and to others that they're meeting their international obligations whilst managing the fish stocks. So there's been four formal consultation exercises that get us to this point. In addition to that, we've had dozens of stakeholder meetings.
Yes, but the stakeholders, who are saying things about this now, are opposed now and were opposed then. So something happened, and this is not a trick question in any sense, Willie or anybody else, something happened during this process, and you've mentioned Europe, which moved from the possibility of a kill licence, which would, I think, have been supported, no matter how reluctantly by some people, right through to essentially a forbidding people to do something. What are the factors? You've mentioned Europe and infraction. Was the weight of that heavier than the views of the organisations? I just want to get my head around the process, the way in which this has swung from where it was to where it is now.
No, it's quite the opposite, in fact. What we have before us today implements the principle of the kill licence in managing vulnerable stocks, but implements it in a way which doesn't have the bureaucracy of the kill licence. And the government actually responded to stakeholders' views that what we were proposing in terms of kill licence was too bureaucratic and too costly and it would take up too much time. So we listened to that, we came back, we reflected, and we considered how the government could achieve its policy and its obligations in a simpler way, which is what we have before us today.
Policy and obligations aren't the same thing. There are obligations from under European directive, there are obligations of various types, and there is the policy. Now, is the policy about ensuring that people can still legitimately undertake their pastime, or is the policy to avoid infraction?
I think one of the key areas that came out of the consultation for the kill licence, which led to where we are now, was a general view that we didn't take into account appropriately local initiatives. So the extent to which local voluntary measures were having an impact and were managing the conservation status. So that was a clear message that was coming through that we didn't take account of that. So the move from licensing to the approach we got now, basically saying we will see whether the local conservation measures, which is why the conservation plan is quite important, works, the extent to which that is able to manage the activity locally. And if it doesn't, it may well lead us back to the idea that it has to be a licensable activity because we wouldn't be able to. Will the local measures work once the conservation status has been determined, or won't it? So it was acknowledging concerns about any charging, any cost associated with licensing, and most anglers were actually not in support of a licensing activity. There was certainly a presumption by a lot of anglers that a license would necessarily mean a certain number of fish you could kill, and there was no guarantee about that either. So that would have raised a different kind of question, and indeed the science by that might have been more difficult. But one of the key changes from the discussion, we had particular lots of discussions in the Tweed and elsewhere, was how were we appropriately taking account of local measures which were in many areas that they considered to be working quite well. And that was one of the fundamental changes that led to the move away from the licensing approach.
I don't want to presume this, other people wish to speak, but I do think that listening more to local views and what worked perhaps is a better way forward in terms of solving conservation problems. And I think the pressure from Europe at one end and perhaps a reluctance to do that has created circumstances in this and elsewhere where we have a problem which we need to avoid in future. But I want to talk about that later.
Thank you. Alec Fergusson.
Thank you, Peter, and I won't take up a lot of time because we have a debate to come, you'll be pleased to know, and I have some substantial points I wish to make on the back of comments that have been made by other members during this Q&A session. But I do want to touch on a point that Mike Russell has just raised, which is the reasoning behind these proposals and the reasoning for the urgency that appears to be behind these proposals. Can I just say I think the government was quite right to come away from the kill proposals that were originally, the kill licensing regime that was originally put forward. I argued at the time it would be almost unworkable, extremely bureaucratic and expensive, and I think the government was right to try to find other measures. But I want to come to the subject of infraction proceedings, which I met when I met with the minister last week. And by the way, can I say that I'm sorry to hear she's not well and therefore unable to be here today, though of course I welcome the cabinet secretary in her place. What I was informed was that infraction proceedings were now live. My question is quite simple. What steps has the Scottish government taken to go to Europe, whoever one goes to, because I don't know, and point out that as a result of the criticism under the Habitats Directive that has been aimed at Scotland and the lack of activity, what steps have been taken to say we are in the process of putting a robust regime in place that will hopefully improve our salmon conservation record and indeed improve the salmon stocks that is the aim of all that? What steps have been taken to go to Europe and say we need a year's delay because the proper science does exist out there, we need a year to assimilate it, and if we get the proper science, we can put forward a proper regime. Can you tell me specifically what action has been taken to secure a delay before bringing in these proposals?
Well, clearly this has been an issue that's been rumbling on for many years in terms of the EU's approach to Scotland's lack of adherence to the Habitats Directive when it comes to the conservation of salmon, particularly in relation to netting stations. And they contacted us and raised the case further in September 2014. So here we are in March 2016, putting through the regulations which we hope will address Europe's concerns. And clearly a lot of work has taken place over that period of time. Since the latest letter from the Commission about infraction proceedings. We think this is now the time to act, and that's why we're here with the regulations. As I said before, the other driver, of course, is also the Wild Fisheries Review, which had its own findings and recommendations and call for urgent action over the conservation of salmon. Many of the stakeholders and members of the committee will be even more aware of this, and I'm sure I am, have been calling for action for a long time. you know, the government has been lobbied so hard for many years by many sectors of the angling community and others who want action taken. So there's been pressure from various directions to take action over some of these issues, because quite clearly we want to conserve the salmon as well as the economic impact of angling in Scotland. I mean, if colleagues want to come in terms of the current dealings with the Commission, they may want to do that.
We, since 2014, when we last had our meeting with EU officials, it became it was apparent that they were not comfortable that we could adequately demonstrate that we were meeting the requirements of the Habitats Directive, most particularly in relation to netting stations, but not only in relation to netting stations. Habitat doesn't just apply to coastal netting, it applies elsewhere. And they were concerned that the explanations as how we explained we thought we currently met those requirements were no longer valid, and they wanted to see some action to be taken place. Since that point, we have kept them in regular contact with them by correspondence and by discussions about the process, starting from the original consultation on the kill licence following the Wild Fisheries Review through to where we are today. So they're fully up to speed as to where we are, they're currently considering our response to their concerns about how we're going to move this forward, and we await a response to whether they will suggest their content or whether they'll move to seeking a reasoned opinion thereafter.
So what, if I could just follow up, Convener, what I think you just told me is that the real concern here is over netting, but that anglers and tourists and others who come to Scotland to fish and take the very occasional fish, 20 per district, as we've just been told, they are the ones that are having to pay an equal price, because presumably one needs to be doing something as well to keep the netsman happy.
No, it's about mixed stock fishing, it's about netting, and it's about anglers, and they're very much all mentioned in the correspondence that we've had. So, no, coastal netting in particular, that goes back to the, as the Cabinet Secretary said, the concerns about our ability to manage the activities of netting stations that are inactive, and also when new netting may take place, which can do that within river, of course. And so whenever a new project or plan takes place, the extent to which it assesses the impact of that project or plan, and therefore whether it should continue. As the committee will remember from previous discussions, we in Scotland have over 400 recognised inactive or dormant netting stations, individuals, and I'm not suggesting that the vast majority of those could ever or would ever take place in a commercial capacity, but they do have the potential at present to start tomorrow and continue to have an impact on the salmon stocks.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Sarah Boyack. Thank
you very much, Convener. Got quite a few questions, because as colleagues have been asking questions, I've had more questions that are coming into my mind about the process, as Mike Russell has tried to dig out here. Can you just clarify for us what point we are at on the potential infraction proceedings, Minister? You said there was a meeting in 2014 with European officials, and you went back to say, obviously, we are addressing this issue, but what stage are we actually at in terms of infraction proceedings?
Well, there's been contact between ourselves and the Commission in terms of giving comfort over what we're doing in Scotland to meet the obligations under the Habitats Directive in terms of the next stage. I don't know if, Jeff, do you want to come in there?
The current stage, as I outlined earlier, was we have responded to the Commission's concerns about our current explanations for how we meet the requirements of the Habitats Directive, particularly in relation to Article 6. We've reaffirmed where we are in terms of the current discussions around this particular regulation and order, and we're waiting for their response. And their response can either move to get to seeking a reasoned opinion on whether that's appropriate or not, or indeed to accept our reply and to close the case which was driving the original approach. I think it's also important, perhaps, that the authors of the original, there were actually four complaints, one of which have slowly dissipated for one reason or another, and it's never entirely clear why they drift away, but the authors of the current complaint, which has driven the ongoing questions about our ability to demonstrate we're meeting the requirements, I recognise that as a positive step and see that as the right thing, that does adequately demonstrate and meet their original concerns.
Okay, so that there's not an actual deadline of a process that we're involved in at the moment. It's still at the negotiation stage between yourselves and European officials.
It's in the Commission's hand. They're due to come back to us, I think, within a month's time, that within their deadline as to whether they would move to a reasoned opinion as part of that process. For the infraction debate.
Yeah, there's an awareness, but there's not there aren't currently infraction proceedings being taken against us by the Commission. Okay. Sorry, did you
say
something?
I'd like to clarify that.
Yeah, I'm trying to get this clarified. Are there actual infraction proceedings being taken against us, and what stage are they at? We're still at the discussion stage, is how I understand it from that answer from the official.
Move to the point where they've begun the process. It's stage one of the infraction process. But whether it moves into the point where part two, which is where they would seek a reasoned opinion to see whether we actually comply, we haven't reached that point yet.
Yep.
So there's a possibility that it will stop if they are comfortable that the current approach meets the requirements.
Thank you for that. It's also quite a lot. It's not an instant process either, though. There's still, even if they weren't happy with what happened today, there's still quite a process involved.
An instant proposal, although they've been quite clear that they're concerned that we have not met that requirement, so it's accelerated over the last period.
Yeah, and you have been doing work on that. Can you tell me what proportion of areas in Schedule 2 are special areas of conservation?
There's 17 special areas of conservation in Scotland.
So what kind of proportion is that in terms of the different areas you've identified in Schedule 2?
We've got 109 fishery districts, and we have the 17 SACs as part of the assessment process that we did.
Yeah. I suppose what I'm trying to tease at is you've already got a set of areas that have significant capacity to control and protect salmon through the special areas of conservation. How effective have the measures in those areas have been?
Most, if not all, of the SECs are Category 1. Which is a good sign in terms of categorisation. So, for instance, the spay and the tay will come into more than one category because the SEC part will be. I think I'll ask for advice on how many are in each category. But, for instance, in the spay, the SEC part is Category 1. So clearly, there's a positive sign there in terms of the SECs being part Category 1.
Yeah, I suppose that's the point I'm coming to, because colleagues have made the point that in the areas where they've had angling interests or fishing interests coming to them, there are concerns about the broad brush nature of the first statutory instrument we're dealing with today. I think they've all been looped together, but the first one that we're dealing with, 115, this worry that we're covering the entire country with, it's either a broad brush or a blunt instrument, depending where you're coming from. But why haven't we taken a more bottom-up approach? When we looked at marine conservation, which has been hugely controversial the last few months, you've at least got local work going on and clear areas that people can focus on a strategy in those areas, whereas what we seem to have here is a blanket approach across the whole country with a promise you're going to come back at another point and go local. Why not do it the other way? If special areas of conservation, as you say, have been hugely successful because they're Category 1, shouldn't we be more proportionate in our efforts to pull up those areas that are the areas that are most concerning and do that with the local communities, put in measures to actually make that work?
Well, to be fair, we're not taking a blanket approach to the country. We've got categorisation. That's the whole purpose of having Category 1s, 2s and 3s. So at the moment where we are is activities can continue clearly in Category 1, activities can continue in Category 2, and indeed in Category 3, albeit you can't retain fish in Category 3. So it's very much not a broad brush approach. That's the whole purpose of taking a categorisation approach to Scotland, because the alternative is to do what some other places have done potentially, which is to say there'll be none of the following activities in any of the country's rivers. We've not taken that approach at all. We've taken, I think, a much more proportionate approach by going down the categorisation approach. So some rivers are totally fine and others have some restrictions and some activities.
So to come to that comment that some rivers are absolutely fine, can you give us more information on the research that has actually been done? Because in listening to previous questions by colleagues, there is a question mark about the quality of that data and why we haven't put data in place first before we've got this mechanism that you're wanting us to pass today.
Yeah. I mean, as I said earlier on, and colleagues will come in to talk about the actual detail of the, the, data and how it's collected. But as I said earlier on, when we moved on from the kill licence issue to where we are now, that was broadly welcomed. But there are some associations or people who've looked at their local circumstances in their local rivers, which are part of a fisheries district, who clearly have expressed concerns. And, you know, quite loudly in some cases, and quite rightly members are bringing forward their representations today. But that's a million miles from taking a broad brush approach across the country, because we've got categorisations, and even within Category 3, only 18% of the fish is caught is retained. So 82% of the activity that previously happened will continue to happen, even though they're Category 3. So I think we just have to keep this in a bit of context here. But in terms of data collection, which led to the categorisations, is that yourself, Stuart?
just to go back to the SACs, it's worth bearing in mind that a lot of those are, so the kind of Tweed, the Spey, the Tear, Category 1s, it's worth mentioning that the South Esk, for example, is a Category 2 river. The Bladnock is Category 3 as well. So there are... It's not quite that all ACCs are being looked after, so they're all in Category 1. There is a kind of mix there as well. With regards to the data collection, it's primarily based on road catches is how we take local data in, but... we base some of the other factors on long-term data collection that we have on the North Esk and on the Gurnet Burn. So they're very detailed scientific studies, plus some of the kind of information from around Europe. And it's important also to realise that the methodology used is very similar to used in other countries. It's not quite the same because there are Scotland-specific reasons why we want to be a little bit different from some of the things that are done in Norway or Ireland, for example. But it is in line with kind of international standards. Having said that, we accept that we can improve it, and we're working on that, and it will be a process going forward.
So there was a couple of questions by colleagues about exactly what would be the support to local angling organisations to carry out that research. What will that support actually look like in practice? Is that financial support going directly to angling organisations?
I'll maybe let other people talk about any kind of financial support. What we're doing at the moment with kind of local fisheries trust is making sure data that's already available or that they already hold is in the right format, and then we can add to the methodology to the process, but also discussing about how information could be used, could be collected in the future, so agreeing standard protocols, because it's very difficult if people think they're collecting the same bit of information using lots of different methods, so we want to standardise how things are collected going forward.
Just to find, how does that actually work in terms of the local fishing and angling organisations? There was suggestion about them getting support through this process, but it's not been easy to tease out what that support is, whether it's to support them for lack of activity, for example, lack of tourism impact, or whether it's financial support to enable them to do the research alongside this research. Yes. It's not actually clear what the mechanisms are at the local level.
There's two things essentially happening. One is there's £100,000 available over the next 2 years to work with the angling clubs to promote their activities, but they fear there may be some economic offset from the categorisations. And secondly, as the conservation plans are put together and Marine Scotland are working, and Marine Science are working with each individual fisheries district that's putting together their conservation plan, we have said that clearly as those discussions are taken forward, we'll have to see what support is required to make sure that these conservation plans are worked up. So that's a kind of work in progress.
Questions? Sarah? I'm going to ask some questions before anyone else does.
Apologies, I thought you were asking that.
If Sarah has any more at the moment.
Not at the moment, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, try and put this in some perspective. The statistics for salmon fisheries, which have been collected in the 5 years from 2009 to 2014, suggest that a total of some
151,731 salmon were, let me see, I'm going to get this right. We have to think about salmon angling, first of all. So the rod and line fishery caught and retained 125,295 salmon and grills. The fishery released was 344,367 fish, with a low estimate mortality rate of 10% for released fish. Another 34,436 would die, and if this figure was added to the already retained catch, that would give us a figure of 159,731 fish. And you've said that the figures for angling information have been undercounted in many cases. That's the situation. Would you agree that that's an accurate figure, given that it's Scottish Government statistics? And a reasonable estimate of 10% that die after they've been caught and released. Yeah.
It's certainly there's differences of opinion about what the stats is, but it's acceptable areas around 10 to 12%, yes, for mortality.
Okay. Yeah. So the next figure I have is that fixed engine and net cobble fishery in the same period caught and retained 118,366 fish. This amounts to some 41,363 fish less than the fish which are caught in the rivers. In other words, netting actually, and we have to assume that it's correctly accounted for, is actually a smaller impact on the kill for salmon than the kill on the rivers for anglers. So the first thing is, do you agree that that figure is correct?
Well, I've got no reason to dispute the figures, but clearly in terms of the coastal netting stations, the other factor is it's mixed stocks that are being caught, which has an overall impact across our rivers. So that's a key point in the infraction proceedings.
Well, I think that the netsmen understand this,
yeah.
And that they've been involved in science to try and collect the data. And indeed, the Environmental Research Institute in Thurso is doing a study at the moment about the Pentland Firth movement of salmon, which is one of the kinds of things that might feed into your review. Is that the kind of thing which you would use during this year to actually collect the data so that you could review particular parts of the country where salmon stocks in rivers were in good condition?
Yes, I mean, there's a three-year prohibition on netting, but with the ability to review within that three-year window if we so choose. And clearly, as you've explained, that kind of science is important because of the mixed stocks are being caught, and we don't know if a disproportionate number of the fish being caught is from a particularly fragile river, which is why mixed stocks in themselves are important to understand. Then the more information we have about that, the better, and the more it will enable us to review any particular part of the country.
Well, Dave Thompson asked some questions about smolt reintroduction into the River Lochy. This has also been successful in the River Carron in Wester Ross. But when anglers are asked, or anglers, I mean riparian owners in this case, not angling clubs, when they're asked about restocking in many other rivers, there's a great reluctance because some people say that it's expensive and that it's less than successful. Now, it seems to me that we have to get to the bottom of the question, is it more important that anglers have fish to catch rather than what the expense is for putting enough fish into the river for them to be able to catch?
These are valid questions which are clearly part of evolving fisheries management in our rivers going forward, and we're clearly a landmark point here where we're taking this a lot more seriously as a country and trying their best to develop better understanding of our salmon stocks, which many people have been calling us to do for many decades. And now, of course, as a country, we're doing it partly as a result of pressure from others, but partly because, of course, we want to do the right thing.
A huge amount of sympathy for angling clubs because they want to have a fish to catch. But these figures suggest that, in fact, in many parts of the country, there is a problem
about what happens to fish that are caught and then released and die, as well as those that are caught and kept. So we need to have some very robust information about that in the next year in order to make a review meaningful for different parts of the country. Is that the kind of thing that you think is possible?
Well, I think it would be helpful for me to undertake to the committee today that within 12 months we'll certainly bring a report back to your successor committee to give an update on many of the issues that have been brought to our attention today, and as well as the big picture, moving towards the river by river approach and some of the bigger issues as well.
Yeah. Well, I've got further... Sorry, you want to say something, Mr. Cowan?
Excuse me. Sorry. I was just going to reflect that this, of course, is part of a broader wild fisheries reform programme, and the government launched its consultation on a draft wild fisheries bill with associated strategy in February. So I think the broader questions that you ask are entirely valid, and we now have an opportunity to debate the question of stocking, ranching, in amongst everything else, which collectively with stakeholders we're looking to develop both a wild fishery strategy and a data and research strategy in order to encapsulate what it is that we're trying to get at and what we need to do to fill the gaps to enable us to get there.
Thank you for that. I mean, it's obvious to me that this is developing science. We can't have absolute science. Proper science is something which develops. It isn't something that is clear at this point and then it doesn't actually develop thereafter. So the question about the science as we know it is a particular problem. I'd just like to stick with an example from a river in my constituency. And a letter from an angler called Philip Gwynne in September last year, and he says that he's a rod fisherman with interest in the River Naver, but has been on the North Coast for many years and knows the Armadale netting station well. The netting station fills an important part of the North Coast salmon world, and he says, I meet with James Mackay, the proprietor, on a regular basis. We've just enjoying a record season on the North Coast, and there is what the river watcher would say was an abundance of salmon. We, of course, electrofish our river, and the major burns on our production of juveniles is in a very healthy state. The fish that return to us are in a very good state, so we can consider that the sea life of the salmon has improved. That's the testimony of an angler in the River Naver on the North Coast on a Grade 1 river. So is your review going to be able to take into account that kind of local evidence from places such as this with a view to then thinking about the status of the moratorium on angling in that area at Armadale?
Well, absolutely, yes. That's what we have to do. There's much commendable work taking place across all our rivers in Scotland, or not all necessarily, but many rivers in Scotland. I think we're all familiar from that from our own constituencies. I represent three major rivers in my constituency, and likewise the members around the table do as well. And we all know there's a lot of really good work taking place at local level. And the more information we collect as quickly as possible, the more we can even have a more localised policy.
Can I just turn finally to the question of the Habitats Directive? I asked you a question on the 7th of August this last year about the diet of seals. And you told me that later in 2015 there would be a report about what seals eat. Now, I understand that the Habitats Directive is focused upon what humans do to salmon and not what seals do to salmon. And the question I have is, can we, at the same time as pressing our case with regard to the human management of salmon, find some way to go to Europe and suggest that it is an unequal fight if we are not taking into account the number of salmon which seals eat? And I can assure you that there's a very good number of seals in the Pentland Firth area, where waters of the North Sea and the Atlantic meet. That's where you get lots of bird feeding, where you get lots of fish feeding, and inevitably you get lots of seals feeding. So the question about what seals eat is material to the way in which the recovery of salmon in our rivers can work. What can you do to help me with the results of that report, which was supposedly coming out at the end of 2015, and what we might do with it with regard to Europe's writing of the Habitats Directive regulations?
Okay. I was filled with trepidation when you said that you'd asked me a question back in August. Thankfully, you told me what my answer was. But in terms of studies, I will check which report that question as referred to. There is, I'm told, a report being published this year on the diet of our seal populations. So that will be available in the coming months and was commissioned by Marine Scotland. There is, of course, some information out there on the diet of seals and some evidence about clearly a small number of seals may take a lot of salmon, therefore a cull of the seal population generally would not have much impact on salmon predation, but I will ensure that we write back to the committee about what reports have been commissioned, what ones are available.
Thank you. Claudia Beamish, final question, is it?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'm trying to find a way through here, and I'd like to make a suggestion. If I've understood it rightly, the possible infraction proceedings only relate to the SACs, and if that is the case, could we look to find a way forward which would only put these regulations onto those and would enable the rest of Scotland to be more localised in the implementation and to have that done as quickly as possible? And would this enable the Scottish Government to go back to the Commission with a robust plan that would delay any proceedings? Because it is, as I think we've seen today, a very blunt instrument, and local rivers really do, a lot of them take a very serious interest in conservation as well as the fishing. And I appreciate there's the issue of the netters and the half netters as well. I know how complex it is, but I'm just trying to see at this stage how we might find a way forward that would accommodate more of the serious concerns.
I think the issues of managing salmon sacks and known salmon sacks are not distinct, they're interrelated. And the habitat's interest in salmon sacks is not only the management within the sack, but potential impacts on the sack from other areas. So we have examples of fishery districts that have sacks further upriver. So fish swimming through a district, have to swim through a district which may have one level of conservation to get to a sack which has another level. So as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned earlier in relation to mixed stock fisheries in relation to coastal nets, there's also an issue in some areas about if you're in an angling club downstream of a salmon sack, which is Category 3, nobody knows if you're taking a fish which is destined for that Category 3 sack and therefore requires further protection of it. So I'm afraid it's not as straightforward as saying we manage sacks in one way and fishery districts in another, because they're all interrelated one way or another.
So just to push that a bit further, why could the... I appreciate this is complex, but the whole issue is complex anyway, and we've seen there are very serious concerns. Could it not be the case that if there is a river that a salmon's going up that is not part of a sack but leads to a sack, that those could be... formed as part of the regulations in the interim before, so that we don't be, so we're not putting people in a position or groups and angling groups I appreciate that netting stations are mixed stock, but so we're trying to see a way through that will enable local rivers not to be categorised in their view wrongly, and from this evidence today quite possibly wrongly, because it's such a blunt instrument.
Yeah, I think...
Sorry, I'm being a bit... No, but you understand what I'm saying.
It's absolutely fine. I understand where you're coming from. I think what ministers have said twofold. One is that we are working hard to put... working hard with local biologists, expert groups, to put in place a system which should enable us to move to a river basis from next year, and these regulations would be reviewed on an annual basis. So in the for 2017, the clear intention is to move to a river basis, and we're working with local people to do that. For the purposes of these regulations, we've said that if individual districts can bring forward additional data, and Stuart talked about the veracity of data earlier, but if individual districts can bring forward data which could influence the categorisation, then we'll look at that data urgently, and if necessary, the government have undertaken to review this regulation in the next session of Parliament.
Yeah, I just want to add that there are, as I said before, two drivers for the regulations before us. One is the Wild Fisheries Review, which said urgent action had to be taken, and the infraction proceedings, which, yes, do place an emphasis on SECs and netting stations. But there's two drivers, not just one. And not passing this today would delay everything for a significant period of time, whereas what we're trying to do today is give you an assurance that for that impact, where there is an impact, we're going to try and review as quickly as possible to get to a river-by-river basis. And the context, overall context, again, is that in the Category 3 rivers, only 18% of the catch is retained, and that's what's affected. So 82% by definition.
A point of order.
Yes.
The Cabinet Secretary just said that not passing this today. The Cabinet Secretary just said that not passing this today would lead to a lengthy delay in its implementation. Am I not right in saying that not passing this today would actually bring it back to the floor of the full chamber for determination? I wonder if somebody could guide me on that.
That's correct. It would come to the whole chamber to be discussed.
Thank you.
I'm intending to take a 5-minute break just now, and then we'll come back for the debate about the motion. Okay.
So we'll reconvene. The second item of business today is consideration of motion S4M 15732, asking the committee to annul the Conservation of Salmon Scotland Regulations 2016, in brackets 2016/115. Should be noted that the Scottish Government officials cannot take part in the formal debate. All members of Parliament who have joined us today are able to participate in the debate at my discretion, but I remind them that only members of the committee can vote. The motion will be moved with an opportunity for a formal debate, which can procedurally last up to 90 minutes. In practice, most of the issues have been covered in the evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary, so the debate should not last so long. I invite Alec Fergusson to speak to and move the motion S4M 15732 that the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee recommends that the Conservation of Salmon Scotland Regulations 2016 brackets SSI 2016/115 close brackets be annulled. Alec Fergusson.
Well, thank you, convener, to get your title correct this time around. Thank you for inviting me to open the debate. I think the last 90 minutes have been extraordinarily interesting and very educational in many respects. But let me just begin, if I may, by repeating the context that Mr. Cowan put to us in that session. There are 83 fishery districts that will become mandatory catch and release under these proposals. 82% of the average catch and release rate 82% of the average catch across that those fishery districts are currently released. And so what we are actually talking about at the end of the day, as we were told, is the life expectancy of 20 fish per affected fishery district. And let me just begin by saying, and I really do mean this, that I am not against salmon conservation measures, and I'm not against salmon conservation limits. I'm very much aware that they are successfully used in other countries and that the model is by no means a new one, even if there are some specific differences to bring in Scottish unique circumstances. But what I am very much against and remain against is the way that the government has gone about introducing these proposals. I do understand, as has been repeated today, that the government maintains it is under considerable pressure from the EU and that infraction proceedings are now apparently live, although today we've discovered they only actually focus on SACs. But I'm not aware that Scotland's MEPs, for instance, have been asked to rally to the call and put a case for a further delay or a deferral of the implementations of these measures, as they surely could have been. And I'm therefore not, I'm afraid, persuaded that the government, as I was told last week, has done everything possible to make that case. Now, clearly, and maybe, the government doesn't believe that a deferral is any way desirable. But I'd like to set out very briefly why I do. And I have to say that everything I've heard this morning has convinced me that a deferral is not just necessary, but that it's required. Now, firstly, I do not accept that the scientific basis for introducing the categorisation of our rivers, as has been the case, is accurate enough for the purpose to which it is being put. Rod and catch returns, even taken over a five-year period, are not the most reliable of statistics. They are unscientific, and they are unworthy of forming the basis for these proposed restrictions. Indeed, two of the 5 years that have been taken into consideration were exceptionally dry, as I think the figures, I think it was for the Nith or the Annan that Elaine Murray referred to, highlighted. And in a dry year, you get considerably reduced fishing effort with a consequential lower annual catch, which according to the science of rod and catch returns, therefore mean that you have a less healthy salmon stock, which is not necessarily the case at all. And the illogicality of that argument was very well summed up in a post I saw on a salmon fishing online forum, which suggested, in fact, I think the wording was, no need to worry, lads, I intend to catch 500 salmon this year, and if we all do the same and put that in our returns, all will be well. Now, of course, that is an absolutely ridiculous suggestion, but it does rather sum up how flawed rod and catch returns are as a basis for legislation. And my second concern is the timing with which these measures are being introduced. Now, while I do understand they were consulted on for some months, until the final proposal of any consultation is published, those who make submissions to it would have hoped that those submissions might well be taken into account and acted on, and even make a difference to the final outcome. That, after all, is what consultation was supposed to be about. And yet, and indeed, the first consultation on licence to kill had that result. Changes were made as a result of the consultation. But the original proposals that were consulted on the second time around and that we're considering today were confirmed by the Minister only a very few short weeks ago, forcing angling clubs, proprietors, hotels, holiday cottage businesses and the many others who rely to one degree or another on angling to make a living, to have to change their focus, change their policies for 2016, face cancelled bookings, reduced fees and in some cases a complete lack of inquiries at all for the 2016 season. All without any compensation at all. The closest angling club to where I live, the Newton Stuart Angling Association, is already £2,000 down on 2016 advance ticket sales compared to the same stage last year. I know the Minister has announced £100,000 over 2 years to help, but I've yet to speak to one angling club, and I've spoken to several, that think this will make any substantial difference to their medium to long-term plans. And what about the netsmen, of whom we've spoken quite a lot this morning, the few large commercial netsmen that remain and the many smaller marine crofters, I would call them, that still exist along the Solway coastline and elsewhere across the country, must surely be due compensation of some sort for this abrupt cessation of their business. And yet that does not appear to be the case. Much has been said about half-netting, and I'm pleased to hear that exploratory discussions are taking place to try to ensure that that cultural activity and that historic activity may be able to continue. I do hope that is the case, and we'll await to see that outcome with interest. But finally, I remain very, very concerned that any measures looking at salmon conservation simply have to refer, or at least I don't see how they cannot refer, to the two main causes, as I understand it, of salmon decline. One has been mentioned by the convener, which is seal predation. But the other is the impact of sea lice. Now, both of these predators, if I can call them that, inhabit the marine migratory path of wild salmon. NASCO, which along with the EU have been critical of the Scottish Government's lack of efforts in regard to salmon conservation, are even more damning of the Scottish Government's lack of action in relation to sea lice, which despite the new legislation in 2013 that we scrutinised on this committee, sea lice numbers continue to rise. They appear to be poorly reported and even more poorly controlled. No one doubts that their impact on wild salmon is immense, as is the impact of the growing and heavily protected seal population. And yet it is Scotland's anglers and netsmen who are being asked to bear the brunt of the government's proposed conservation measures. So what I'm asking for through this motion to annul is a delay in the implementation of the government's proposals. A day that I think would allow several currently empty boxes to be ticked. Now, firstly, the government has already said, and we heard it again this morning, they have brought together a group of existing biologists to assimilate the science that already exists on the health of salmon populations on a river-by-river basis across almost all rivers in the country through the work of the many excellent fisheries trusts that we have. And I have to refute the Cabinet Secretary's assertion that up-to-date, proper, robust science doesn't exist. It does. It's a question, surely, of bringing it all together, as the government has said it intends to do within the next year, and that would allow a proper river-by-river categorisation. And that is proper science that, as I was told in a meeting with Dr. McLeod last week, as I say, hopes to be assimilated within a year. So let's delay the implementation for a year until that proper science backs up the measures. Secondly, a year's delay would allow a time for angling associations, clubs and the others I've mentioned to adjust and for their clients to similarly adjust, because what we're talking about from their perspective is dramatic behaviour change. Now, behaviour change is something we've often talked about on this committee in a variety of circumstances, but I don't think any of us in our wildest dreams expect behaviour change to happen overnight, and yet that's what we're asking here. And thirdly, and I think most importantly, a sensible delay would achieve the buy-in of all stakeholders, and that is something that is certainly far from universal at this point in time, but which I believe is absolutely essential if this policy is to be successful, as it surely needs to be. Without that buy-in, salmon will continue to be killed, even if that's illegally, because these proposals are almost unpleasable. And that if that is the result, then these measures will turn out to be virtually worthless. So why don't we harness our MEPs and let's encourage them to earn their apparently meagre salaries by making a case on Scotland's behalf for a sensible delay, if only for 1 or 2 years at the most, to ensure that the measures work, that they are brought into by all stakeholders and achieve what we all want to see, salmon populations increasing in a sustainable way for the benefit of principally our environment, but also our angling interests alike. I do not believe that the current proposals in their current form will achieve that outcome. We did clarify that this measure will not come to the chamber unless the committee turns it down today. I do believe, genuinely, these are serious measures with a huge impact across Scotland. I believe they deserve to see the full gamut of our democratic processes behind them. And I think that they deserve to be brought back to the chamber. So I hope, and I would appeal to the committee to back my motion, if only for that reason alone, so that this process is seen to have the full democratic process behind it. And on that basis, convener, if I may, I will move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. I've got several people who wish to speak. I'm going to take Mike Russell, Jim Hume, then Jackie Bailey, and then Aileen Murray.
Thank you, convener. I remember, one of the things I remember most vividly about my early days as Environment Minister was going to Strathay Point to the salmon netting station there to see the late Simon Patterson, this would be in July 2007, to tell him as Environment Minister that the licence that he had had for many generations in his family was not going to be renewed. I remember it because I went with somebody who the Cabinet Secretary will remember, David Dunkley, who was Her Majesty's Inspector of Salmon, a man who knew more about salmon than anybody else had forgotten. And I remember it too because I believe I shouldn't have done it. I believe that the setting of environmental policy by fiat from central government is not the effective way to do it. And if this committee doesn't know that after the MPA process, then it will never find it out. That the reality is that we should negotiate in a painstaking way with those who are the stakeholders, as we call them from here, the people who actually earn their living by fishing or working the land or doing a range of other such activities, the people who are often sustained by a very, very long tradition of so doing, and we talk about half-netting lightly, but half-netting not only goes back to Viking times, but its legislative basis goes back to 1649 in Scotland. And it also has a place in Scottish history and tradition, and in an area I'm particularly interested in, the Scottish photography. I'm sitting here in front of me with a picture from the early 1900s of casting the maul, casting the right for various positions along the net. And somebody I've written on extensively, Verna Kissling, took photographs of salmon netting, half-netting, which are a very important record of a traditional communal activity. So I think the right way to have approached this and the right way to approach a whole range of things, in the environmental sphere particularly, is not to move to regulation or legislation until the community, the stakeholders, those who know from doing the detail of the issue, have come to a common mind or a conclusion, no matter how difficult that is, and it is difficult, and it sometimes is almost impossible, but it needs to be done because you build the blocks, and then on top of those blocks, you put the legislation or the regulation. And if you do it the other way, we get to the type of thing we saw in the MPAs, and we get to here. We get to a situation where quite clearly there is an issue, a widespread issue across Scotland, where people are saying, let's do this a different way. And the different way is, at this stage, to have a river-based model. And we've already talked about that, and how important that would be and how that would move us the step we need to move. So there is a genuine problem here, and I am going to back the regulation for one particular reason. Because we are 2 weeks from dissolution, and if we do nothing now, we run the risk, and I go back to David Dunkley, we run the risk of continuing to run down the salmon stocks and the possibility of their recovery. But I only am going to vote for it if I hear, and I hope I will hear from the Cabinet Secretary, an assurance that as soon as possible after the election, we're going to move to a river-based model, and we're going to work hard to get to that model. So in actual fact, the views and influence of those people who are doing the things for which we are legislating and regulating, those are the people who in the end will get what they need to have. I don't think that this is a great end to a session when we're struggling with that issue, which is a process issue. But what it might teach us, as the MPA process, I hope, has taught us and other things have taught us, is that there's a better way of doing it. And we can learn that also internationally. I've mentioned at this committee before some of the example of reconciling traditional, often called native land use, and environmentalism, and the necessary work of conservation has been done elsewhere. And we should be learning that in government and that as a parliament, because that's what will make a difference and will last. Because we're not talking about change for a week or a month. We're talking about long-term change that can restore the environment we all want to see. So with some reluctance, I'm going to back this regulation, but I do look for a commitment from the Cabinet Secretary that this is not the end of the process, but in actual fact a brief hiccup in a process that will produce the buy-in that we should be looking for as the basis for environmental change.
Jim Hume, followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've heard today, I think, a lot of doubts over the actual science. We've talked about rod counts. The rod counts are obviously counted on only in the rivers, and as we've heard from many members here, and members not just of this committee, but members who have decided to attend today, I think that's a record. A number of MSPs who have actually attended this committee that I can recall. So that perhaps shows to me the concerns of this Parliament regarding this legislation. Rod counts, of course, only are counted on rivers. When rivers are dry, the fish don't run, they stay in the sea. And that's where the half-netters catch their odd fish or not. We've heard that the Minister's optimistic that, that they'll come to some sort of arrangement that the half-netters can come off, can carry on in some form, but that's all in the future. At the moment, they have an uncertain future. I asked about compensation, which had been mentioned by the Minister of the Environment herself. That seems to be off the table now, as the Cabinet Secretary seemed to state that they were not considering that at this moment in time. I will be backing Alex Ferguson's amendment motion to annul. Absolutely, a motion to annul on the basis that this Parliament can have the ability to then discuss it fully. And I don't buy that we don't have enough time. We can easily fit in an extra hour. Next Wednesday, we have a whole day on land reform, so we could easily fit in a small slot so that the whole Parliament could absolutely debate this extremely important matter. Because it is true, as other members said, I think it was Aileen Murray, that salmon fishing brings a huge amount into rural economies. And we're actually competing on a global market. There's other great salmon rivers in Russia and Canada, so we want to be seen as somewhere that you can fish and take the very, very odd salmon, with having absolutely no effect on the conservation of salmon, which, of course, I fully support. Thanks.
So Jackie Bailey, followed by Aileen Murray, and then Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener, and my apologies, I'm going to have to leave immediately after. Can I start by saying I support the motion to annul? I recognise I don't have a vote in this, but I do have a voice. It strikes me that we're at a process that is at the 11th hour, 59th minute, and unpacking how we got here, I think, is something that is instructive. And I agreed with much of what my colleagues previously have said. It strikes me, and the Cabinet Secretary, by his own admission, said, we've been pushing to do something for a while now. And it strikes me that the threat of EU infraction is the thing that's motivated people after perhaps years of not taking the appropriate action. Now, I understand we're at the very early stages in relation to the infraction proceedings, so there is time. I understand that the proceedings relate to SACs and netting stations and not what's going on in local rivers. So there perhaps is a tighter set of regulations that could be brought forward. So I think we're in danger of, because we've been slow to act over many years before, of taking panic measures at the last minute, at the closing stages of this Parliament. And I was always told taking action is one thing, taking the right action is even more important. I recognise again this is complex, but what we seem to have as an approach from the government is past this and we'll just worry about the detail later. It is, by their own admission, the complexity that will involve a degree of time being taken to get this right. We've waited years, we shouldn't rush at this. The Cabinet Secretary said he would rely on the input of local bodies after. Question for me is why we didn't rely on it before. It's disappointing that they haven't taken on board the science, the data available to them now, in particular the data from Glasgow Uni and the Loch Lomond Fisheries Trust. They've not listened to local interests in the consultation, and they've not undertaken an equality impact assessment. But actually, for me, this is about Loch Lomond Angling Association. They're 116 years old. They have something like 700 members. There's a low-cost activity for working class men predominantly, but hopefully for more than that. They care passionately about conservation, but they're saying that these regulations don't actually do what the government want them to do. So if the Cabinet Secretary isn't prepared to withdraw and bring back a much tighter set of proposals that focus on the issues that are absolutely the subject of the infraction proceedings, then I would be in favour of abandoning the order, or if there is some way of the whole Parliament considering it. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Aileen Murray, followed by Sarah Boyack.
thank you, Convener, and I also will be speaking in favour of Alex Ferguson's motion to annul the amendment. It is clear from today's evidence that this order is prompted by the threat of EU infraction and not by the science of salmon conservation. Indeed, in proposing this order, the Scottish Minister has obtained a rare achievement in uniting the Dumfriesshire anglers and the Solway netters, who are frequently in disagreement. However, the government has united them in opposition to this order. The Environment Minister was well aware of their concerns, as I had forwarded every one of them to her and her officials, and I was advised that their representations would be taken into consideration, but unfortunately there is not much evidence that this is the case. All the organisations which have contacted me fully support salmon conservation, as indeed I do. And of course they do, because the future of their activities and the angling clubs depends on the continuation of a healthy population of salmon in our rivers. This is not about fishing versus conservation. The objections concern the data and the information on which the decisions underpinning this order have been taken. The Annan Common Good Fund Subcommittee of Dumfries and Galloway Council administers the operation of poke, half and stake nets on the north side of the Solway. They believe that the legislation will have a devastating effect on all netting activity, including Annan's traditional fishings, which we know are enshrined by Royal Charter. The income of the Common Good Fund will fall and its potential for investment in Annan with it. The Common Good also considered the categorisation of the River Annan as a level 3 river is based on inaccurate data and should be reassessed, as the River Annan has been a productive river for 3 of the past 5 years, and the Council has already for several years implemented conservation measures locally. This blunt instrument of an order contrasts sharply with the approach taken with respect to the River Eden in Cumbria, where an agreement has been reached with the Environment Agency and Natural England on an acceptable level of catch. Rod angling clubs in Dumfriesshire consider that fishing tourism will be badly affected if this order is passed, as potential visitors will prefer to spend their time and money on rivers where they are permitted to keep maybe just one of the salmon they catch. Indeed, Cumbria Tourist Board will probably celebrate if this order is passed. Angling clubs, already struggling to survive financially, may cease to exist. The River Nith Angling Association and Dumfries and Galloway Angling Association also, like the Common Good, consider that the science behind these proposals is flawed, pointing out that there are virtually no fish counters on our rivers recording the number of returning salmon, and the categorisation is based purely on the number of rod-caught salmon. The reason for a perceived decline could be just that there are fewer anglers catching fish, or that rather than there are fewer salmon. It could be about the weather, as others have said, and the salmon stocks are cyclical anyhow. Anglers tell me, for example, that stocks in the River Nith currently are high. Fishing is important to tourism in Dumfriesshire. Our rivers are one of the region's great assets, and losing fishing tourism would have consequences for other tourism businesses and the local economy. And one of the unintended consequences, as Alex Ferguson referred to, could actually be the stimulation of poaching. And I'm sure that's not something that any of us would wish to see. I urge the Cabinet Secretary to reconsider this order, which could threaten the future of angling clubs on the river Annan and Nith and the historic half-netting on the Solway and fishing-related tourism across the region. I hope he might consider retracting this order and reconsidering it. But if he will not, I will ask the committee to reject the order and allow Parliament as a whole to consider and vote on its contents.
Thank you. Sarah Boyack, followed by Graham Day.
Thank you very much, Convener. Well, I have to admit, I came into the chamber today having read all the evidence and having listened to colleagues, and I was actually deeply disappointed at the answers the Cabinet Secretary gave to some of our questions this morning, because instinctively, I do want to support more action in salmon conservation. But what we've got in front of us this morning is a kind of work in progress. Don't worry, we're thinking about what we're going to do next. We will get round to it later, please trust us. And we can't give you the details at the moment. And this is too important for that kind of approach. I know this is our last committee of the session, but we need to get this right. And we know, actually, from the Minister and his officials' answers, that where we have salmon conservation measures, they do work if they're done properly. So we need to have the right strategy in place. And the reason I asked about special areas of conservation is because we need that right strategy in place over time. We need to monitor it, and we need to think about how we prioritise the areas where action needs to be taken. So I don't think the approach we've got today is appropriate. We can't have those kind of shortcuts. We need to be looking much more at the rivers and their catching areas and following the lives of salmon. And that's one of the lessons that we've had. If you look at conservation, it's not just one point in salmon's lives. You've got to follow that whole track and think about the things that will impact on salmon stacks throughout that whole life cycle. So that's partly a geographical issue, and it's partly an issue of time. And that all needs to come together. And what we have in front of us, that we've got a take-it-or-leave-it approach today. It's a very blunt approach. And I know, as a new member of this committee, that there has been a lot of evidence presented to committee, and you have taken a great deal of work over the last few months. But I think the lessons from previous evidence to this committee do need to be learned. We have spent the last few months debating marine protection areas. And what really came through loud and clear to me is the importance of having a national overview, having a national commitment that we all sign up to politically, but then having the capacity for ironing out the details between local communities and conservation groups and ensuring that you have a good evidence base. Now, we're never going to get 100% agreement on that. I know that, having taken evidence, that is an impossible place to get to. But we do need to have better, good information that people can at least debate around, and a clear focus and a strategy in the areas involved. And I feel what we had with the MPAs, for all that there was disagreement, was a more transparent and more accountable approach. We don't have that today. So, as I say, we've got a challenge because this is a negative instrument and we're at the end of the Parliament. But I think there are better alternatives that the government could be pushing. And I pick up on the point that Mike Russell made about a river-by-river approach, a priority-based approach, the comments that my colleague Claudia Beamish made in her questions. Stakeholders all need clarity and they need to have to work together to conserve salmon stocks, to enable our angling for the future and to enable biodiversity for the future. And local management groups are absolutely key to that. The points made by Jackie Bailey about the Ecology's impact not being properly examined, I think, is concerning. The points that both Aileen Murray and Joan McAlpine made about the cultural impact this will have on half-netters. And I think we did get some movement today from the Cabinet Secretary, which I welcome. But I think this could be done better. The points made by my colleagues Rhoda Grant and Dave Stewart in conversation are about conservation and cultural heritage and tourism and conservation measures working together in concert. It is difficult. I take the point that Mike Russell made, and I get the sense that he's going to tip over on the other side of the balance today. I'm not going to support this going through the Parliament today. I think we need to come back to it. In this case, I think there are too many unanswered questions, not just about our local communities, but about the overall approach and whether it's right. And I am not convinced by the answers I've had from the Cabinet Secretary today. There is a better way to do this, a more proportionate way to do this, that will prevent the stocks being run down further, that will get a better outcome. And I want to just finish on the point about the European infraction proceedings. We are at the early stage, and I think if we were to debate this in chamber next week or the week after, there would be agreement across the parties about wanting to implement European regulations, because this is about the protection of the environment and about a vital fishing stock. We do need to do that. Every party will be signed up to that. The point is doing this in a way that is effective, and that's not what we've got here today. We've not got good protection for salmon stocks and local biodiversity that will work with our local communities. They need to be part of that picture alongside the important conservation movements we have in this country. And passing this motion, not saying anything today, letting this go through, is the wrong approach, and it's not good for our salmon stocks for the future. So I will be supporting the measure to annul so that we have a proper discussion, and so that as the parties, as we move to weeks of disagreeing with each other, we could agree that there's a better way forward. That's the sense I've picked up from members across this committee. Thank you, Convener.
Graham Day, followed by Claudia Beamish.
excuse me. Thank you, Convener. I respect entirely the concerns which have been articulated by other members today, and I understand their motivations. But I think it's important that we don't lose sight of the twin drivers for these moves, conservation being one, and the other one is the infraction threat, whether it's immediate or coming down the track. Nor should we lose sight of the fact that anglers are still going to be able to catch fish. They just won't be able to kill fish. And that's in order to ensure that we have a real future for the sport. With regard to the fishing tourism point, I would point out that the River Dee has been operating a 100% catch and release scheme for some years. It remains an iconic must-fish river, and it attracts anglers from all over Europe. And the Cabinet Secretary is correct when he says that without fish, the anglers, tourism will dry up anyway. Having said that, local buy-in is important. And I'm like Mike Russell, I would want further assurances around quick and appropriate engagement at a local level going forward. But if we get that, I too will support the measure and oppose the motion to annul. We should have taken action long before now. We cannot keep putting this off. That approach has served us badly with deer. We should learn from that. You're always going to have people disagreeing with a planned approach. Sometimes you have to do the right thing, but then be fleet of foot in adapting to circumstances changing and improvements emerging. And if we have that assurance that the government will do that, then I will support this.
Thank you. Claudia Beamish, Dave Thompson after that.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to speak in support of Alex Ferguson's motion to annul. That was not what I intended to do when I came in to the committee today. I was wanting to support this. I was trying so hard to support this. And I've had a lot of information from local groups from across Scotland, which I've tried to represent some of, saying that they're concerned about the methodology. As this morning's developed, I have really reached a stage where I'm not able to support this SSI, because I think the method, if we wait for a year, the methodology that could be more localised and look at more of a river basis, which we, as I understand it from the Cabinet Secretary, will be coming forward in the next year anyway. I think that will bring the groups on board who are involved, and the salmon fishery boards and the district boards and local anglers and conservation groups, and that it will enable everybody to work together for the aim which everybody, as I understand it, wants, which is a robust salmon stock per se, as an iconic species, and also for the future of the enjoyment of fisheries. I accept what Graham Day says, that there are iconic rivers where there's catch and release already, but I think this is a behaviour change issue, and there are some rivers where this is not happening yet. And I think if we delayed for a year, that we could put the £100,000 the Cabinet Secretary has has mentioned could be offered into part of this behaviour change process. And all the way through this committee, we've looked at bringing people with us and at behaviour change. And I know that this is such a serious issue, but I think the stage we're at on infraction with Europe, as I understand it, is not that far on. We're not at the point of the letter of formal notice yet. And I think that if we were able to ask the Scottish Government, I'm asking the Scottish Government to consider withdrawing this today and going back to Europe and saying, these are our plans. This is what the buy-in is. We have so many local communities on our side. We don't want to lose that, and we're at risk of losing that for the future. And I think there are many arguments that have come through today, and if we debated this on the floor of the chamber, would come forward then as well about to prove to Europe that we are taking this incredibly seriously. For the future of our rural communities and for our rivers and for the joy that fishing can bring to so many people and the tourism issue, I'm going to support Alex Ferguson's motion to annul today.
So Dave Thompson and Joan McAlpine.
Thank you, Convener. Well, I've listened with great interest to the debate this morning, and I have many salmon rivers in my constituency, not just on Skylock Alsh and Lochaber in the west, where there's at least a couple of dozen, but also the Spey and the Ness are both in my constituency as well. So this is a big issue in the constituency. And, you know, a number of people have expressed concern about processes and so on at this morning's session, and I have a lot of sympathy for those concerns. And I think that although there has been engagement with local communities and so on, maybe some of that engagement could have taken place a bit earlier and it maybe could have been a bit better. But I do believe that the government is now engaged. I do take the word of the Cabinet Secretary that there will be rapid action on reclassification and getting down to specific rivers, so that if there is an error with the Ness, as is claimed by Mr. Sutherland in speaking to Dave Stewart and Rhoda Grant, that can be corrected very quickly indeed, or indeed other rivers where the classifications are wrong, they can be put right. So I do accept that the government will do this, and they'll do it extremely rapidly. I was also pleased to get the assurance in relation to the River Lochy and the ranch salmon there that the government will be ensuring that this project, which has been going on for quite a number of years now and very successfully and is attracting more people to fish on the Lochy than ever before. Fish are coming back into the Lochy in a way they haven't done for many, many years. So it's going to be a hugely beneficial process in terms of tourism and everything else to allow this to continue. And I am reassured from the assurances from government that the ranched fish with the clip fins and so on, that something will be done to help us with this situation. Before the meeting, I did discuss, this was discussed with John Gibb, who runs the Lochy, who's the head bailiff in Lochaber there. And his view, when I asked him, when he was asked directly, you know, would it be better if this order didn't go through in relation to these matters? Or if he got the assurance, would it be a good thing if it went through? His advice to me was, it would be better if it went through. So on the basis of that and other information that I have, I'll be supporting the order today.
Thank you. Joan McAlpine.
Yes, thank you very much. I don't have a vote as I'm not a member of the committee, but I've listened with great interest to the points that have been made and have sympathy with both sides. I think it's been a very, very interesting debate. I appreciate the point that Sarah Boyack made about let's go to the chamber within the next couple of weeks to debate this, and that might be a very interesting exercise, but I think realistically I think we probably all know that that's just not going to happen with 2 weeks left to the Parliament and a very, very packed parliamentary programme. So therefore, while that might be attractive, it's simply not going to happen. In terms of some of the points that have been made with regard to my interest in the Solway, I think it's important to clarify that in Annan, the stake nets and the poke nets, the fixed engines that are already there and whose income has been withdrawn from the Common Good Fund, that has happened as a result of action from the English side, from the River Eden, where the authorities there were threatening legal action against the Solway fishermen, and the Dumfries and Galloway Council actually chose not to go to judicial review on that, and that's why there aren't any stake nets there anymore. I very much welcome the news that the Scottish Government have listened to many of the representations on behalf of the half-netters, who are in a unique heritage position. And I was concerned at some of the suggestions perhaps coming from Jim Hume that, you know, that this was still open to question. And in summing up, I would appreciate if the Cabinet Secretary could give us some assurances that that there is going to be some kind of exemption for half-netters, and they will be able to continue to fish in some way. Because one of the things that's come out of this debate very strongly is the need for better scientific evidence. And if the half-netters could contribute to that, I think that would be an imaginative and very welcome development, given that half-netting is something that's passed from father to son and grandfather to son, and goes back such a long way. These are the people who really understand the stocks and who really understand the fish, and I'm sure they're people who would be in the best position to actually contribute to that scientific evidence. So, you know, I welcome the movement of the recognition of human ecology, as well as the preservation of fish, and I would very much welcome just a little bit more clarity from the Cabinet Secretary in his summing up on the future of half-netting on the Solway. Thank you.
Okay. All members asked. Just have some comments myself. I didn't ask before, but it's important to know who the complainers are about the situation for the health of the Scottish salmon stocks that have led them to go to Europe. I think we should know who these are, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary can remind us. I also think that it would be important to recognise that across the Northern Hemisphere, in Alaska, in Norway, in Russia, and of course in Ireland, that catch and release is a very big part indeed, in some cases 100% part of the sport that takes place. Were Scotland not to move in that direction, I think it would be showing that we are behind the curve, and that if Scotland is going to be seen as a place for people to come to fish, then I think we've got to work against the competition, in the sense not of being able to catch some fish, but to be up with the best practice, which is happening in Alaska, Norway, Russia, and so on. If that's the case, I'm very unhappy about the fact that the question of sea lice has been brought into this by the proposer of the motion at the moment, because both the Lochy and the Carron are rivers that have been restocked, and they're in areas with large amounts of salmon farm fishing there, and it is working in terms of the restocking. So I think we should be very careful without bringing that issue back into the picture. Now, members are talking about delay. Any order which is brought forward in the following year would not be a silver bullet. It would be another stage along the knowledge path that gives us a picture of what salmon is like in individual rivers. And I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary suggests that data collected during this year will be able to be deployed within the year, because the order includes an annual review. That being said, taken alongside the Wild Fisheries Review and the draft bill which has been consulted at the present time, the matter of how river catchment areas are managed for all species of fish is a very important part of the surround to this set of orders. And it seems to me that the democratisation of the rivers and the river catchments is one of the things which would be a win-win for angling associations to gain, because at the present time we've seen a reluctance by riparian owners to restock rivers, despite it being a practice in some of the better ones, such as the Naver. And if that's the case, we need to bring those pressures to bear, and they're a part of actually improving the salmon stocks that has not been discussed in this order, but is utterly germane to the picture and the overview which we take about this order at this time. So I would like to suggest that while Sarah Boyack can suggest that all parties would be signed up to the Habitats Directive, I don't think that would stop them voting against this order if it came to the floor of the Chamber. And I don't think that that would alter the way in which the science has got to be taken forward, or indeed that the review has got to be taken forward, or indeed that action has got to be taken to stabilise the salmon stocks. So therefore, I'm going to be supporting the motion, not the motion to annul, but the proposal by the Cabinet Secretary, and I would ask other members to do so, because I don't think this is a question of it's got to happen now or it'll never happen. It's not also a question of saying that anything can ever be perfect, and I think that we've got to recognise that this is a very imperfect situation that can only be taken forward with the best will in the world by a government that's intent on making sure that we do have sustainable salmon stocks, and I believe this government does. Cabinet Secretary, do you wish to reply to the...
Thank you very much, Convener, and I've listened closely to the comments, and often powerful comments, from all parties and members of the committee here today. Clearly it's inspired some strong views, because like many issues relating to our environment that have an economic social impact, it's full of challenges in how we plot the best way forward to strike the proper balance. And I've endeavoured this morning to explain the context for the conservation regulations, and also the extent to which we have engaged heavily with a broad range of stakeholders, especially since the publication of Andrew Thin's report, the Wild Fisheries Review, back in, I think it was October 2014. So where we are today is not perhaps as rushed as some people are pointing out. But I think it's been a very candid exchange with the committee, and as I said before, I've listened very closely. I do consider the regulations strike the right balance between conservation of the species for the benefit of future generations, as well as the interests of those who fish for salmon today. And importantly, I do believe the way we're suggesting going forward will keep our rivers in Scotland open. And as we've discussed previously, we have looked at other countries close by, such as Ireland, where we do not want to end up in terms of where they have had to go on an annual basis, choosing which rivers remain open or close. And that would bring a lot more instability than some people are suggesting may happen with these regulations today. And I think it's in all our interest to avoid that scenario in Scotland. The introduction, I should also mention, of course, that the UK government recently also announced that they're consulting on mandatory catch and release across England as well. So these issues, these challenges, are not unique to Scotland. They're happening elsewhere in the UK. They're happening in other European countries. I think the introduction of these measures readily demonstrate that we do have a scheme that we can put in place that will manage exploitation in line with the requirements of the Habitats Directive, as well as meeting our international obligations to NASCO as well. I also want to reiterate, in response to some comments, that this is a broad brush approach in Scotland. As I said before, you know, let me emphasise that this is the opposite of a broad brush approach, because we've specifically, unlike the scenarios that are happening in other countries I've just mentioned, taking a categorisation approach where there's three categories of rivers across the country. In two out of the three categories, activities can largely continue as is. The third category, which has dominated a lot of the conversation quite rightly today, are those areas where there has to be mandatory catch and release. And we're currently around 18% of fish is retained. So I'm just trying to set the wider context of today's regulations and the impact they will have. But notwithstanding that context, The committee members have quite rightly highlighted concerns in relation to Category 3 rivers and the need in the future to go to a river-by-river basis and that approach. And that is something the Scottish Government certainly supports. In light of comments Mike Russell and other members who've asked for assurances from the Government, I reiterate that I will instruct officials and ministers who are dealing with this issue to come back to your successor committee early after the new elections with more details of the way forward and the timetable attached to that. And I'll be confident that that should happen before the summer recess. No doubt the requirement for further report after the summer recess, more work has been carried out in terms of going towards a river-by-river basis and the way forward for recategorisation of the rivers who are in Category 3 at the moment, who may be able to input more data and accurate science in the times ahead. So I hope to give that commitment today clearly and the assurance that that timetable and the way forward can come back to the committee very soon. I just wanted to make two quick comments that, yes, the whole principle of a bottom-up approach to these changes that are required as we continue to develop this policy moving forward are absolutely the heart of the Scottish Government's approach. And in terms of taking into account local initiatives and local culture in terms of the half-netting that takes place in the Solway, which a number of members, particularly Joan McAlpine and Jim Hume, have mentioned, just to again give an assurance that our absolute intention is to find a way for those skills to be retained and for that activity to continue, albeit it will have to be through a scientific project and a scientific approach. So I just want to put on the record that assurance that I believe Jim Hume and Joan McAlpine were looking for as well. But doing nothing is not an option, as many members have said. We have to ensure we do have a framework in place from here on in that will protect what is an iconic species for Scotland and delivers all the benefits that many members have referred to. We have listened to and acted upon the concerns that have been relayed to the Government about retaining the fundamental principle that any killing of wild salmon, a protected species, absolutely has to be managed in Scotland. It has to be sustainable and we can't allow threats to be in place of what are vulnerable stocks. We will continue to make improvements to the process. I take on board the criticisms and, you know, these are difficult issues. And yes, there are pressures from Europe in terms of infraction. And indeed, we have to fulfil the spirit of the recommendations from the Wild Fisheries Review, which we want to support. However, failure to approve these regulations, I do believe, would set Scotland back significantly and risk our international status in terms of salmon fishing in Scotland. The infraction proceedings from Europe is a real factor, as many members have mentioned. It's not the only factor. Conservation is number one priority. But it is the legal position that we are aware that this is one of the areas Europe is taking seriously in terms of Scotland's environmental credentials, and the infraction proceedings are real. And at any point this year, the European authorities could take us to the European Court. And they'll, of course, be paying close attention to what's happening at the moment in the Scottish Parliament in terms of protection of salmon. And for the record, it was the Salmon and Trout Association that the convener wanted me to mention that did make the complaint to the European authorities, which no doubt have partly led to where we are today. So for all these reasons, convener, I urge the committee to reject the motion for annulment, accept my assurances, which I hope address some of the concerns that have been expressed by members today, and allow us to move forward to protect what is the iconic species in Scotland, our salmon stocks.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I ask Alec Fergusson to wind up and indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw the motion.
Thank you, Convener, and I'll be as brief as possible because I think most of the arguments have been made and stated and I don't want to do a great deal of repetition, but I would just comment on a couple of points that have been made. It is certainly not just Jim Hume and Joan McAlpine that have an interest in half-netting. Claudia Beamish, Elaine Murray and myself have all spoken about that. We all have constituency and regional interests in that activity, and I think we would all welcome the fact that you know, dialogue is in place to see if some measures can't be put in place to ensure that that cultural activity is continued. I'm afraid I don't apologise for bringing sea lice into this debate. There are huge numbers of fishermen and anglers in my part of the world who believe that the sea lice behaviour plays an enormous part in the decline of salmon stocks in or the health of salmon stocks in my part of Scotland in particular, alongside acidification, seal predation, and indeed other measures. And I don't see how we can not look at these things in the round when we're doing so. Something we didn't really talk about in earlier questions is the input of voluntary effort into the success of our angling associations, our river management, the restocking activities that we've spoken about. Enormous amount of that is done by voluntary input. And and that's why the buy-in to these measures are so important, I believe, because if we don't get that buy-in and we lose a lot of that voluntary input, then actually encouraging the regeneration of our salmon stocks becomes all the harder. And I really do feel that quite strongly. And I'm sure we all of us with rural constituencies are aware of the importance of that voluntary input. I think, as Mike Russell said earlier on, there is an element of putting the cart before the horse here. And I am going to press my amendment, and I do so with some sadness, because we're all after the same thing here at the end of the day. We all want the same outcome. And yet we have clearly slightly different views on how best to achieve it. I have to say that I think Joan McAlpine is wrong in saying that this cannot come back to the Chamber. If the committee was to back my motion today, it would have to come back to the Chamber. That's the process of this Parliament. And I do believe there are an awful lot of people out there who have concerns about this. These proposals, who deserve to see this being agreed by the whole chamber of this Parliament, if necessary, rather than by a majority on this committee. It might not change people's minds, as the convener suggested, but I do believe there are proposals here that can be accepted by the whole chamber. I'm not convinced these could be, but it is important that the proper parliamentary and democratic process is seen to be done. So on that basis, if on no other, and I believe there are other bases, I would ask members to support the motion in my name, which I press.
Thank you. So the question is that motion S4M15732, in the name of Alec Fergusson, be approved. Are we all agreed? No, we are not agreed. So would those who are in favour of the motion please show? Thank you. Those who are against the motion, please show. There are no abstentions. So there are 4 in favour of the motion and 5 opposed to the motion. So therefore, the motion falls. And we will report this in due course. And I would thank members for the detail that they've gone into in this discussion. And I record the results, and that the committee's report will confirm the outcome of the debate. Thank you. We move on to some subordinate legislation, and in case there's any questions, these are 3 items: salmon carcass tagging, Scotland regulations, Tweed regulations on carcass tagging, and the Tweed regulations on salmon conservation. I wonder, and the Common Agriculture Policy Direct Payments, etc., Scotland Amendment Order. Just in case there's any questions on the salmon or any of the others, I will ask members if you have any questions just now. Sarah Boyack, which one is it?
Just a brief question on the CAP reform one.
Well, we'll come to that at any. Any on the salmon ones just now? No. You're fortunate because you've got the Cabinet Secretary here, but you can ask a question, I think, yes.
Yeah, it's a question that came at a meeting I had with farmers from the Lothians last night, and it was a plea as much as anything, Cabinet Secretary, about timing. I'll not comment about the financial effects issue because we'll debate that endlessly later. But it was a plea for them about the timing of when guidance is actually delivered. Their comment was, if it comes out in the winter, they're already committed by then, and guidance that came out in the summer would be immeasurably better for them. And also the point they made was that for some of them, it's not just an annual decision they're taking, they're potentially rotating crops and rotating fields over a 4, 5 or 6 year period. So the capacity for that to be taken on board was something that they were very keen to see recorded in our debate today, and also that I passed that on to you as a comment. Thank you, Convener.
Secretary may or may not wish to reply because he's not here formally to answer this, but I'm sure he'd be happy.
Well, I'm happy to say it's a point. It's a fair point, well made, and I'll certainly take it away and reflect on it.
Good. If there are no other comments from members, then I ask the committee: are we agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments?
Nobody does. Okay, in that case, thank you very much for that. We move on. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary and your team. We move on to public petitions now. The fourth item of business today is to consider PE 01547 by Ian Gordon and the Salmon and Trout Association Scotland on the conservation of Scottish wild salmon. I refer members to the paper, invite any comments from members and what action we wish to take. Anybody wish to comment on this one? Given the previous interest in wild salmon, I'm surprised that we're not having any comments at the moment. We've got two items here. We've got, it's recommended that the committee welcomes the action taken by the Scottish Government to recognise the issues raised by the petition in its regulations and draft national strategy and draft bill, and that the committee may wish to close the petition and write to the petitioner to inform him of this decision. Yeah. Are we agreed?
Indeed, yes.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. Agenda item we've got the goose petition. Yeah, that's, I was thinking that's what I was coming to. So the second petition today is PE 01490 by Patrick Krause on behalf of the Scottish Crofting Federation on the control of wild geese numbers. Refer members to the paper and invite any comments from members. Mike Russell.
I believe this petition should remain open. The goose problem is far from solved in any part of my constituency. And indeed, my office told me on Monday afternoon, I had a man on from Lismore who said that the most useful thing I could do during the election campaign would be to go to Lismore with a gun and shoot geese. There is a very considerable concern that continues. I'm slightly concerned by the way in which the Crofting Federation seeks to divide crofters and farmers on this issue. There is a common interest between crofters and farmers right across my constituency and elsewhere with this issue, and we require continued action, and I'm afraid that the matter is not resolved so far by the Scottish Government. So I'd like the petition to remain open, and I hope the successor committee will take it on board.
Great. Graham Day?
I completely concur with Mike Russell. I think it has to remain open. The problem's not going away. I think closing it would send the wrong message to the government, the current one and the next one, and to the stakeholders. So I would support keeping the petition open.
Thank you. So Claudia Beamish.
To say that I agree with the two previous speakers.
Chris MacDonald.
There's no doubt in my mind that this petition has to be kept open. From the latest submission provided by the Scottish Crofting Federation, there's still problems with grey rag and barnacle geese on the Uists. And I know from personal experience that the issue on the Isle of Lewis is far from resolved. And we're hearing anecdotal evidence at the cross-party group on crofting that grey rags are now spreading to inner Hebridean islands, as Mike Russell has just alluded to. So the next RACI committee must ensure pressure is maintained on the Scottish Government to ensure proper funding for goose management programmes. And I think to reiterate the point that was made when this petition first came to this committee, if we're not careful, it'll soon be crofters that are endangered, not the geese.
Thank you. Are there any other comments?
I agree with the rest of the members.
Yeah. Well, we've got several things we should think about. We consider bringing the comments of the petitioner and the information from the Parliament of Norway to the attention of the Scottish Government and SNH. So we would agree to do that, would we? Recommend to our successor committee via the legacy report that it may wish to consider examining the outcome of the review of wild goose management by SNH, with a view to deciding what further action, if any, should be taken on the petition. And I believe that we should add to that that there should be proper funding for goose management in the budgets of SNH, etc. Are we all agreed about those lines of action?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you very much.
Open.
Yes.
It does.
Oh, definitely.
Yes.
Sorry.
But I beg your pardon. We have resolved so to do.
Yep. We have resolved to keep the petition open, and it's part of our legacy to the future. So the fifth item on our agenda is consideration of a draft annual report for the parliamentary year 11th May 2015 to 23rd March 2016. I refer members to the draft report. Any comments?
Yes.
No, it's the annual report, which is a short but very succinct document. Yes.
There's a reference to the first time that the minister had given evidence in a rural location, referring to Dumfries. I think it should be Dumfries and Galloway, because Dumfries itself is a town and it reads rather oddly.
Thank you. Any other comments with regard to the annual report? If there are no further comments on the annual report, are we agreed to sign it off?
Yes.
Okay, I advise members that the annual report will be published on Friday the 11th of March this year. So, we've come to a point in the meeting when I usually outline what will be happening next week. However, as I noted earlier, this is the committee's final meeting. I would like to say a huge thank you to everyone who supported the work of the committee, which I've had the pleasure of convening for the duration of the session. I've been ably supported by my deputies first, Annabel Ewing, and latterly Graham Day, and I thank them both for stepping into the hot seat when required. Thank you also to all the members of the committee, past and present. You've all made an enormous contribution to the work of this very busy committee, and I thank you for your dedication and commitment. There are two members in particular to whom I would pay tribute, as they will also be standing down on behalf of the committee. I wish to Alec Fergusson and Dave Thompson all the very best for the future. Alex has been a member of the Scottish Parliament since 1999. His interest and dedication to rural affairs has been evident throughout his career in this Parliament, fulfilling party spokesperson roles and as convener of a previous incarnation of this committee. As presiding officer, he commanded the respect of members from all parties, and he's also a dedicated servant of the people he represents and of this Parliament, and we wish him well for the future. I think he's left us already. Dave has been a Member of Parliament since 2007, a member of this committee since April 2014. He's also a member and former convener of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee and a tireless advocate for his constituents. I thank him for his dedication to the work of this committee and his valuable contributions and wish him a happy retirement. I would like to thank the staff who have supported the committee's work, from the official report, Media Relations Office and Broadcasting and Security. And I'd also like to particularly thank the clerks and the team from Spice for their detailed and often arduous work. Finally, I'd like to thank everyone who's engaged with the committee, from the stakeholders who regularly challenge us to seek better outcomes for rural Scotland and its environment, to those who have taken an interest in our work by joining us in the public gallery, none more so than during the deer management discussions in 2013. Is that the correct year? I think it is. 2014, is it? That's right. In closing, I would like to add on behalf of the committee our best wishes to our successor committee or committees. And as previously agreed, the committee will now move into private session to consider its work programme and now close the public.
No, before you do, before you do. Alec Fergusson isn't the only one of the original Rural Affairs Committee members to be seeing not only his time on the committee, but his time as an MSP drawing to an end. The convener, along with Alec, Jim Hugh and myself, are the only original appointees to survive the joys of committee reshuffles, albeit Alec did have a brief spell away from the committee when his contribution was greatly missed. And like Alec, Rob Gibson has opted to retire as an MSP. As the deputy convener, I want to, on behalf of the members past and present, thank Rob for his enormous contribution to the work of the RACI committee. Rob has brought a detailed knowledge and a great passion to the role of convener, and his determination to improve rural Scotland is as obvious now as it was back when we first convened in 2011. But more than that, I think he's been an incredibly fair and inclusive convener, always ensuring that the members, whoever they were, had the chance to ask the questions and have their say. I think the consensus that more often than not we found as a committee around a wide variety of issues is a great deal to the approach that Rob's taken to convening it. If I'm re-elected to Parliament and go on it to convene a parliamentary committee at some stage in the future, I know I'll be a better convener for having served as Rob's deputy for the past 2.5 years. But I do suspect that today sees Rob say cheerio to the RACI committee rather than goodbye. I have a hunch that our successor committee will be hearing from him in a variety of subjects, not least of all in land reform in the years to come. I'm sure we would all wish Rob well in his future endeavours.
Thank you very much for that. Yes, thank you.
The newest member of the committee, perhaps by, I think Sarah might have been a week or two after me, but she'd sat on the committee before and I hadn't. Can I just say that I've known Rob for, 30, more than 30 years. And I have to say that although I've always had a respect for him, even in his musical incarnation, which has been quite frequent, I believe my respect for him has been at its greatest over the last 14 months, where I have thoroughly enjoyed the experience of being on this committee and very much enjoyed the experience of being a committee chaired by Rob Kirsten, who does it supremely well, whose knowledge of this subject is voluminous, and although he can get a little tetchy from time to time in the chair, he has guided this committee through some very, very choppy waters. I'm grateful to him, and I'm also grateful to my colleagues for the experience I've had in the last period, and if we are spared, all of us who are intending to come back, I do hope I will be sharing a place on this committee with some of my colleagues in the next session.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Okay, thank you, folks. All I should say is that, as we said in the previous debate there, you know, making decisions are never silver bullets. We always have to come back to subjects, and it is a matter of process, but also a matter of progress. And I think that, like devolution and the powers that we have, it's also not something that is an event, but actually something which we take forward with the best of our ability at the time we take the decisions. And inevitably, they're not as perfect as they could be, nor is the convening as perfect as it could be. But I certainly have enjoyed it, and I hope that everyone who comes back has a great time, whether they be in this committee or not. And those of us who are retiring will not be too far from watching how you get on. So thank you very much for all of that in public. I now close the public part of the meeting.